friends, family, and fight fans. Welcome back. Jeffery Wilson is right here live and direct from the River Center in downtown Davenport as we set it off and get ready to kick off Cage Aggression 33, the Trifecta, where once again we're going to be seeing fighters coming in from the UFC, Bellator, LFA. 70 fighters in total have made their way to the Quad Cities to kick off and be a part of this crazy historic event. Now, the last couple years, man, there's been no shortage of obstacles thrown in front of event planners, promoters, but I'm telling you what, the LFA of Cage Aggression, Mike Goodwin, has taken those and rolled with it, pumping out event after event after event. And last March, being the promoter, and the Cage Aggression being the first promotion ever to kick off a three-night mixed martial art event. And here we are about to do it again. Big shout out to the entire Cage Aggression team for all of the diligent hours and hours of work behind the scenes that we don't see that make this weekend possible. I'm telling you what, I'm super stoked, and I'm even more stoked to be calling the action with my broadcast partner on the stick tonight. He needs no introduction, but you know, I'm giving him one. He is the very first UFC lightweight champion, El Primo Uno, the godfather of the division, little evil Jens Pulver. What's up, my man? Well, we got our work cut out for us. I'm telling you, dude, we're going to do it, man. What's your thoughts?
No, I'm excited as always. Look, again, coming from this is it. This is the capital. This is where the Mecca always has been. Where, again, I always talk about where I came across the pond. I came all the way from Seattle. Took a train to come out here. This is where it should be. I'm so glad that MMA is here in the Quad Cities. And it's just, again, there's been a lot of things that have messed up for the last 2 years. It's made it really hard. But this is like our backbone, right? At least in my world, this is the backbone of why I'm here and why I love the Quad Cities. So I'm glad that we're here to see it three nights in a row. It's hard to beat, man. It's a lot of fun.
It's about to kick off night number one. But again, through the resilience of Mike Goodwin and his admiration for not only the fighters, but the sport in general, he made all of these things happen during the pandemic. So hats off to Mike. I'm telling you what, I'm stoked. I got goosebumps, man. It's so good to be back here. Like you said, the Mecca, the headquarters of once the Miličić fighting
I'll
system.
Say it.
We got Pat Miličić standing behind the camera over
That's
there.
That's why I'm nervous. I got a coach. I got nervous. I got the man, the myth, the legend, Miličić standing right there. It's like, you know what I mean? That respect is there. It's like when you see him still to this day, it's like, yes, coach. You know what I mean? I'm instantly humbled back to, and I love it. I'm instantly humbled to that young fighter. And again, to be able to come out here, have me commentating, him commentating, and just remember the MFS, the pioneers that we were, the massive, to be able to come out here and fight in front of us and stuff like that. I love it. I love that we can build it here in the Quad Cities.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's so cool for me to be a part of such elite company. Again, hats off to the entire Cage Aggression crew, Mike Goodwin. It's about to kick off, ladies and gentlemen. So without any further ado, let's do what I like to say, and that is get on the good foot and do the bad thing. Let's toss it up to our ring announcer, Jason Vargas, to kick off night number one of Cage Aggression 33, the Trifecta.
Ladies and gentlemen, fans of all ages, this is the moment you've been waiting for as 7G Distributing Bud Light proudly presents Cage Aggression 33. The Trifecta, our special
mega three-night event hosted by the River Center. My name is Jason, your official voice from inside the Camba Cage. Tonight marks the start of a very special weekend. Over 70 different fighters from 9 different states have come together here at the River Center for a historic, action-packed 3 nights of MMA. This is the Trifecta, ladies and gentlemen. Special thanks to our event partners for helping to make this weekend possible. The River Center, official home of Caged Aggression MMA. 7G Distributing Bud Light, thank them often and thank them responsibly. La Quinta Inns and Suites, Ducky's Formal Wear, Galesburg, The Dam View Inn, McCarl Family Racing, Yabba Dabba's House of Glass, Stand and Protect, Iowa Auto Club West, Elite Loyalty Management, Old Town Heating and Air, The Sneaker Vault, Squirrels Tree Care, Delph's Pro Gym, The Cigar Social, Banker's Life, Kaylee Stout, and Mitt Beast Boxing and MMA. Let's give it up for our event partners one more time, ladies and gentlemen. Special thanks to our production team, Mind Print Productions, The Music Connection, and Say Uncle Photography. Much gratitude due to all fighters and coaches and teams for their tireless commitment to be here this weekend. And of course, to Caged Aggression President, CEO Mike Goodwin, for your unending dedication to the sport and its athletes. Let's give those folks a round of applause. All of tonight's bouts have been sanctioned by the Iowa Athletic Commission. Deputy Ben Wilson, Inspectors George Chamberlain and Benji Williams. Cage side tonight are Greaseman Kevin Night-Night Anderson, our timekeeper Clint the Antagonist Anderson, our judges Alex Orozco, Ian Haas, and Matt White. Our cage side physician tonight, Dr. Metcalf. Helping us keep track in between rounds, the lovely Serena, Dot, and Jessica. Our commentary during the pay-per-view tonight provided by Jason Bermas, Jeffery Wilson, and UFC veteran Jens Little Evil Pulver. And of course, when the action begins, our referees in charge, Josh Stewart, and the boss, Bruce Allen. Don't forget, folks, we've got a booth set up in the back corner. We here at Caged Aggression, we like to give back to our athletes any way that we can. And you all know how much work it takes to get to this point here this weekend. There's nothing better you can do to show your support for your fighter than to go back, buy a special custom event t-shirt, limited time only, get their name printed on the back, and a portion of those proceeds go to that fighter that you choose. So don't forget, visit our friends back there at the Sneaker Vault and on behalf of Old Town Heating and Air for your special event t-shirt. Now, if you'll please rise and help me welcome Local 4 News, WHBF TV host and former Miss Iowa, Michaela Hughes Shaw, for the playing of our national anthem. Let's hear it one more time, ladies and gentlemen, for Michaela Hughes Shaw. All right, fight fans, this is one of my most favorite parts of the show. I have a feeling everybody out there has been looking forward to this just as much as I have. I'm gonna need everybody's help in the building now. I need everybody to get out of their seat. Come on, River Center, stand up, stand up, stand up. There we go. All right, if you guys are ready for the action begin, I need you to get loud. I need you to show them what a River Center crowd sounds like. I need you to make some noise. Let's let those fighters hear you in the back. Let's go.
And here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Night number one at Caged Aggression 23. The trifecta is underway. I am calling the action right here with my boy JB, Jason Bermas, and the first ever UFC lightweight champion, Jens Little Evil Pulver. Boys, let's do this.
The excitement is real, Jeff, and we've already got the polls going. We've got Michael Bilotic coming into the cage, and he is the favorite right now in those polls at over 55%.
Michael Bilotic facing off against Peyton Winzel as Michael Bilotic makes his way to the cage. He grew up watching UFC and always wanted to experience an MMA fight at least once in his life to test himself. interesting factor here that they're both debut fighters, and it should be interesting to kick off with this promotion here. Obviously, Caged Aggression feels that his grappling and top control is his best attribute. Loves GSB and his mentality when it comes to martial arts. Again, I've asked you this many times, champ, the pressure of the first time stepping into not just any kind of cage, but Caged Aggression cage in front of a worldwide audience.
What is that? The biggest thing is, again, make sure you hear me this. That's the thing, confidence, training, making sure that you have that game plan and just kind of let everything do the work. I know you got the nerves, but that's why repetition.
Yes.
Feel that autopilot so you can get out there and just kind of let everything happen and worry about the small details. But that's, like, right off the bat, I always keep talking about this. The first 30 seconds, it's always my favorite time. How are you going to do that when you go across that cage? Are you ready? Are you ready? Let's go. What's that initial thing you're going to do? How are you going to get the heart rate to slow down and get control so that you can learn how to listen to your corner and try, so everything's not such a blur, right?
Yeah.
It's not a street fight. We got to get out there, and we have a process, and hopefully we'll see how he does. Confidence.
Got to stay focused. Discipline. JV, how's that pole looking here, my man?
Biletich in the lead against Wenzel for about 10%. Wenzel about to enter the cage.
Peyton Wenzel is about to step in the cage to face off against Michael Biletich. Started MMA when his best friend was killed. He dedicates every fight to him. Feels good, feels confident in his striking and his grappling. Looks up to Mr. Colby Covington and the Iceman Chuck Liddell. Colby Covington recently in the news, pressing charges against Gamebred Jorge Masvidal for chipping his tooth or whatever went down in Miami.
I don't know if I'm sure how that, yeah. It's,
hey, if we're not getting paid for it, man, keep, look, we're in a restaurant trying to eat, dude.
As much of a fan as I am of Masvidal, I wish that hadn't occurred.
Right.
Because, look, they fought. Colby Covington was clearly the better man. And in a world without Kamaru Usman, he's the champion, let's be honest.
I've heard that talked about quite recently.
Well, one thing is, I mean, Ben Askren said it best, ironically. You had 25 minutes. You had your chance. What are you doing? You
know it's just a bad look. It's a bad
100%.
Look.
You know, Askren tweeted that out. We talk sometimes, and I have a big, big, big appreciation for Ben and what he brings to the sport, because he did bring kind of a unique attitude, as well as Masvidal.
Well, no, no, no. Even in the face of defeat, getting that quick, you know, knee to the grill like he did, he still is engaging, and I think, like you said, it's a credit to the sport. As Peyton Wenzel steps into the cage, gets ready to step into the cage, walking down the runway there.
Draped in the American flag, by the way.
Absolutely. Looking forward to this, gentlemen. Always awesome to be back in the River Center calling some scraps with you boys.
Love being home.
Absolutely.
Love being home.
Feels definitely like home as we knock out history once again. Another three-night event. Our first scrap of night number one of Caged Aggression Trifecta. The Trifecta.
And his coaching staff is pumped up.
Like, did you notice that? My man was feeling it. He's feeling the vibe.
You know? Walkout.
Hey, that's the thing, though. This isn't just about you, the fighter. Yeah, I mean, you're going to go in and you're going to represent, but everybody, you know, that's the beautiful thing about the family side of it, where you put everything together, all the training, we're all feeling it. You know, I mean, sometimes, like I said, it's harder to be on this side of the cage watching or coaching. You want to be in there representing.
Well, like they say, you can't take them in there with you. You got to get in there and do it yourself. Peyton, final preparations. Get ready to step into the Caged Aggression cage for our first scrap of the evening. How's that pole looking? Any movements?
Yeah, actually, Biletich is going a little bit higher.
Ladies and gentlemen, 58%. Our first bout of the evening is scheduled for three-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Middleweight Division, powered by the Sneaker Vault. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 6 feet 2 inches tall and weighed in at 185 pounds. He trains at CU MMA and Fitness. Joining us from Urbana, Illinois, Michael Biletich. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 6 feet 1 inch tall and weighed in at 186 pounds. He trains at Iowa Top Team and Weber's Gym and is sponsored by Ray's Timeout Clinton and Ray's Pub Donahue. Joining us from Clinton, Iowa, Peyton Wenzel.
I gotta tell you, fellas, I've been waiting so long for this trifecta to kick off, I might have an adrenaline dump.
It is good to be back in the saddle.
as this first scrap is about ready to go down as Bruce calls a start to the action. Round number one, touch it up in the center of the cage. Ooh, nice 1-2 coming out from Wenzel. Takedown attempt here from Biletich.
Biletich under that leg, being successful. Looks like he might get full mount, and that would be very, very bad news for Wenzel.
Got those legs locked up.
Well, and you notice, see, Wenzel held onto that neck for too long, and now it's too late. You can see where Biletich, I'm going to say Miletich, I swear it's coming.
It's so close, right?
But he was already giving up the mount before he let go of that head, and that's that transitional period you have to always be wary about. Know when they're going to get, quote-unquote, the takedown. Know when you're in trouble, bail, and start scrambling. But by the time he let go of that head, Miletich has already got him in a bad spot.
He's got him smothered like gravy on mashed potatoes here, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see if he can take advantage of this position.
Wenzel trying to crowd his body and keep away from the attacks. Blocking those shots for now.
A couple of those landed there, but he's doing a good job of defending. Nice attempt to hit escapes here.
You know what? He's bucking him. He's going to turn it around.
Did. Wow. Impressive. Back. Both fighters back to their feet. Testament to Wenzel.
And you don't see a lot of that. A lot of that was brute strength. What do you think about that technique to get up right there, James?
No, I mean, that's the timing of it, right? Because sometimes it's tough because you want to sit there and smother and hold that position, but you also need to strike. And when you get up, you get too crazy with the punches. You're giving that space. And he did a good job of bumping him, and Banger got him turned over.
Good knee. That one hurt him. That stung him, guys.
Yeah, I didn't know.
He looks like he's in pain from that one. Pick it up. Yep, okay.
Biletich has him on his back.
Now, again, see the position. He's got to be careful. Hold on to the head. See, he started. There was a moment where, in that transition, when you're hitting the mat, you can start to pummel in and create that before everybody gets their bearings. But once Biletich was able to get hard and heavy like he is, now you're stuck. He needs to start. See how he's holding on to the head? That's the single worst thing he can be doing. He needs to pummel, get inside so that he can make that a lot more difficult and start looking for that transition to try to get up.
Stepped over pretty easily. Almost looked like he might go for a head and arm, but now it looks like he's trying to flatten him out for strikes.
Like some more brute strength coming from Wenzel.
Dang! Brute strength.
This kid. Biletich has him up against the cage, dropping more knees.
When those knees are connected to the body, I'm seeing him wince. Biletich doing a decent job on that, putting all his body weight on him here. Another knee to the body. That one didn't quite land. Wenzel's going to have to try to turn him around somewhere.
Yeah,
it looked like he was trying to move him right there. He's got one underhook over there.
See, now he's lifting up that leg, doing things to try to stop those knees. Those knees are paying dividends. The Biletich can see that. Again, frame on the face, heavy. I like how he's got the head in the pocket. Doing a good job on the underhook side. Nowhere really to go. Keep throwing those knees.
And this is going to be about a wrap to the first round. Exciting fight. Looks like Biletich on top in that first round. What I'd like to see him do, except other than go for full mount, guys, is when he's in that side control, he's having success with the knees on the feet. Take one of those knees, put it into the body on the ground, see the reaction, and who knows, maybe you get that mount in some strikes, because so far, when he's had that full mount, he hasn't really been able to devastate him from the top.
Like you said, advancing that position with our taking advantage of those knees, like he's finding so much success on his feet. Bring some of those to his ribcage. Uh-oh, dropping some ice here in the corner.
Yeah, I mean, everybody, I think the whole idea of that, the mount, it has too much hype. Coming off to the side, I mean, it's hard to stay on top of somebody, especially with the power of Wenzel, the way he's able to turn it. But staying off to the side, you can really hunker down, elbows to the head, knees to the body. I mean, little things like that, you know what I mean? You press him down more, but everybody likes to go to that mount too soon.
Well, like you said, sometimes when you're swinging like that, it helps you, it lends itself to losing that position. Well, like you said, Wenzel's got some strength, man, off his back. Here we go, round two. Wenzel starting out with another 1-2, finding a home with that right left.
The right hand landed twice right there. Biletich almost absorbed that one, but see, you can tell this is his wheelhouse right here, getting that body lock, pressing Wenzel up against the fence, utilizing right here again. I like, take that right arm, frame on the face, or now take the left one. Either way, throw those knees to the body, because it's obvious Wenzel does not like it.
No. Second round starting out very much so like the first round did.
Under that leg, now he's going to get success.
There he goes, got him down.
First time we've seen him in half guard here. Yep.
See if Wenzel still got that juice. Get off his back.
This will be a lot harder. Obviously, I like this. Again, sitting right here, sitting in half guard, go cross body, pressure on that arm. You can start to work on, like, again, post with the right arm, land shots with the left, little things like that. But then, see, just start working those strikes right there. You got nowhere to go. You're in total control right here. Did he slide into the mount?
No, Felix hits the half guard here.
Nope, he still got that leg trapped. Looked almost like he was going to try to step in. Now he's trying to step over.
Trying to slip it out. Get that full mount.
And it looks like there might be an attempt at a head and arm, but at this level, I'm not sure. He's got to get way further away from the cage and get his leg out. I'd like to see him posture up and just try to drop one straight elbow down.
Good heavy shots. Yeah, that's exactly. Posture up.
And there he is, using that elbow right there.
Big shots.
Here comes the right.
Ooh.
Hammer fist from the top.
Wenzel with a nice right
hand. Another hammer fist. Wenzel fighting from the bottom like I've never seen.
Look at this guy.
Oh, my goodness.
My man is fighting, but he needs to be pushing on the leg because this is the inevitable. But he was throwing shots from his back.
There's about 1 minute left here in this second round. Both fighters giving it all.
You know, an admirable attempt from the bottom, but honestly, you know, he has so much power and he's been able to get up. He would have been better, in my opinion, try to trap one of those arms, turn him over, and get up. Because look, he's still in this position. Now he's taking the shots.
Yeah, now
he's a little open. Now he's turning. That's what I want to see, the buck and turn.
Utilizing that power, time one, push on the knee, get the shrimp in there, pull the knee, get half guard. It's just a matter of time on intelligence. Even though it's not hurt, it's still going to have to stop it at some point.
30 seconds left. Bruce Allen taking a look. Unanswered shots coming here from Biletic.
I would just be worried if I were Biletic not to gas out completely before this third round. You know, these guys are in their first fights. They're about to have 6 minutes in both. But he's a pretty heavily muscled fighter. And the more muscles there are, the less oxygen you get once you start doing those big, big shots.
We'll see here at the end of the second round what kind of labored breathing he has, if any. Check his, check that conditioning. You guys know all too much over the Belichick fighting system, man. That conditioning, make sure that gas tank.
It's everything. Wenzel surviving down here, though.
And the question is a round like that where, you know, he's pretty much mounted the entire round, maybe not the first 30 seconds or so. Is that dominant enough for a 10-8? That's the real question.
I would say yes, other than maybe because he was trying to throw from his back. You know, I don't know. Even though it looked cool, it wasn't. There's not much to it. Again, with all that energy, and you're obviously getting hit, it's time to push on a leg, shrimp up, get half guard, get full guard, and start to push away and get back to your feet. But
like you said, it looked cool.
It did look cool, and maybe that kept him from giving a 10-8 because it didn't look as dominant-ish.
Right.
You know what I mean?
No, absolutely. I mean, the effort was there, but, you know, again,
I'm in a bad spot, but I'm still throwing.
I'm still throwing,
so it's not a 10-8. But I always say in MMA, one of the things you start looking for a 10-8 would be when you have to give up all offense and go on defense. And you try that to survive, that's when you start looking at 10-8. And since he went offense off his back, it's kind of a tough moment.
Wenzel definitely looking for a shot right left. Gets crowded almost immediately by Biletic.
There you go.
Biletic is doing what's worked for him. If it ain't broke, don't break it. Got Wenzel up against the cage here.
Again, head in the pocket, does a good job, goes in on the double. And this is where Wenzel, again, right here, see, he just holds on to the body. The inevitable is coming first. He's going to get mounted before he lets go and like this. And now he'll have to let go. And now he's right back into the situation where he was for the last two rounds.
Looks like he's going for an arm triangle there. I can't tell here.
Oh, yeah. We're going to step off to the side, go for the arm triangle.
Might have to have an arm choke right there, guys.
I think he tapped.
He got it.
He tapped. Biletic with an impressive arm triangle here at the beginning of the third round. A very game Peyton Wenzel, though. Nothing to be ashamed of. Neither of these fighters having this be their first outing in the cage.
Dominant performance by Biletic.
Really was.
You know, obviously there's some points in this game that he's going to have to, you know, polish up a bit. But I would say that him crowding his ground game, getting the submission, it's a great start to a career.
Without a doubt. For a first fight, can't knock that hustle.
A lot of action. And that's it. I mean, he did a great job. He had his game plan. Like you said, Jay, he got the takedown. He knew what worked for him. He went in, he got the clinch, head in the pocket, which I really like.
grab that double. And you know, and on Wenzel, for Wenzel, I think the biggest thing, man, you're very, very tough. Just you got to utilize and put those parties in a different direction. You just held on, you're squeezing at the wrong time. You got to just kind of pay attention, know where those positions are. And we've seen the explosion a time or two, utilizing, swimming underneath, getting those underhooks, pushing on the leg. But that's it. But his toughness is there, so that's like the hard part.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Bruce Allen, has called a stop to this contest at 46 seconds into round three, declaring your winner by submission due to arm triangle choke, Michael Pilatich. Come on over here for a second, Michael. Hey, first of all, congratulations on the tough-fought win. Hey, coming in here, first fight, get a solid submission win. Talk to us how it feels now.
Feels great, you know. I've been waiting for this moment for a while, and it worked just the way I wanted it to.
Well, so saying that it worked out the way you wanted to, you came in, got a pretty quick takedown, and kind of got the takedown whenever you wanted to through the fight. Was that the plan coming in?
Yeah, I wanted to take him down, get him out, and finish an arm triangle. I wanted to do it round one, but happened round three, you know, it's all right.
Well, you said you've been waiting for this for a long time. I gotta ask, Michael, what's next?
I'll probably fight again.
All right, well, hey, anything that I've left out or anything you wanna add before I let you get to the celebration?
Thanks to all my friends and family who came to support me, all my friends and family watching at home, and most importantly, thank you to my coaches, because I came to them about 18 months ago, no wrestling, no martial arts experience, and I worked hard, but it was thanks to their coaching and the program they've built that I was able to go from untrained to ready to fight in that amount of time. So thank you to them.
Well, I can tell you this much, we're definitely looking forward to seeing what's around the corner, but until then, let's hear it one more time for your winner, ladies and gentlemen, Michael Pilatich.
Oh, Bud Light sells for retro tiles?
Have you tried these yet?
I'm sorry, ladies. It's my roommate, Emmerich.
Emmerich? Is that Irish?
Bud Light sells for retro tiles. The loudest flavors ever.
Yes.
Impressive victory there for Michael Pilatich. Being his first fight, he's got a pretty solid foundation to build on, doesn't he, Champ?
He does. I liked it, man. Good pressure. Sticking with the game plan, you know what I mean? Dealing with the adversities of someone trying to squeeze on your head, yeah. You know what I mean? And staying patient enough. Like, there's a point we get frustrated, you know, but he just stuck with the game. I liked it.
Discipline. Discipline. A lot to build on. Looking forward to seeing him fight again as we got Juan Resendez versus Santonio Jackson here for fight number two as Juan Resendez makes his way into the cage. Aggression Cage fighting out of One Touch Fight Team. And he has been a fan since childhood. He's excited that his first fight, this is his first fight as well. He's grateful his opponent took this fight on short notice. Without him, he wouldn't be fighting. He feels well-rounded, ready to go anywhere that the fight will take him. He's a fight fan to the heart. Mike Tyson stands out as one of his favorites. And role models are his teammates who he's witnessed from the start of their journey, grind, compete, and continue to win. Choosing this lifestyle turn, choosing the lifestyle of an MMA combatant has turned his life around. Every year, he's getting a better version of himself. I'm worlds apart from the 20-year-old version of me. And we've talked about this so many times, Champ, how mixed martial arts in general has been a conduit to help people change, turn their life around.
It's a lifesaver. It gives everybody, again, it's a different style to go out there and hold yourself accountable. Go out there and train. It's life-changing. I'm so glad this came about in time in general, right? Where you don't have to sit there and do the street fighting and things like that. The one thing I loved about it is this is just the best testing ground in the world. It's MMA. It's going out there. There's nothing like it. Nothing like it. I miss it, but, yeah. You know, I'm glad. But, no, I'm happy. I'm happy that people have found this.
Juan Resendez, talk us up on the poll we got going, JB.
Well, he seems to be in the lead by a large margin, clocking in at almost 69% as opposed to 31. So if you think Santonio Jackson is coming here to do the business, get on those poles right now and let us know.
That's an interesting hefty lead he's got for being an unestablished, untested commodity here.
And I love how I've seen the poles grow over my last year plus with Cage Aggression.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, Cage Aggression, what a great promotion. Nobody doing three-night events. We saw this young gentleman, Resendez, come down with another fighter who's going to be in the cage tomorrow night, Mackenzie Stiller. Can't wait.
Santonio Jackson makes his way into the cage, fighting out of Midwest Combat. He's always loved combat sports. His friend, Brent Heathcock, who we'll be seeing later this weekend, introduced him to Mike, and here he is. He thinks it'll be a good learning experience. It's an interesting way to get some learning experience, but it can happen. He'd say his game can be improved in a lot of levels, but it's still early in his career. Feels his mentality is his strongest attribute. Looks up to Brent Heathcock, like I said, we'll be seeing very soon this weekend. He took this fight on, I believe that says 3 days notice. He's been training for 1 month. Wow. Taking the fight on short notice, recognizing, you know, he has humble pie on his plate at all times, recognizing he has a lot to learn. But a step into the cage to, like you said, step into this proving ground, which is the Cage Aggression MMA cage.
And Heathcock accompanying him into the cage right there, getting in his ear, letting him know it's time for the business.
Yeah, absolutely. Brent Heathcock, no stranger to the Cage Aggression cage, or to the fight game period. Like I said a couple times already, we'll be seeing him later on this weekend.
He has put on many an entertaining scrap in this arena.
And he stayed busy too since we last saw him. I follow him on the old book face and the gram, and he's definitely keeping his tools sharpened. I don't know, man. There's something, something seeing these fighters stepping in for the first time, the first few times, and then watching them grow and develop, I find so very fascinating.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for three-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Featherweight Division, powered by Old Town Heating and Air. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 5'7" tall and weighed in at 145 pounds. He trains at the One Touch Fight Team and Academy and is sponsored by Belcor Electric, Super Tacos, Muy Mexican Restaurant, and Maxi Clean LLC. Joining us from Richmond, Illinois, Juan Resendez. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5'9" tall and weighed in at 147 pounds. He trains at the Midwest Combat Club. Joining us from Decatur, Illinois, Santonio Jackson.
And both fighters have that stone cold look in their eye. Juan Resendez, he's got the cup marks on there. Tell me about that, gents. What's your opinion on the cupping?
Well, as long as it's just maybe to get the blood flowing and, like, you know, as long as it's not an injury. That's kind of a telltale sign, hey, I'm injured, I'm cupping every day, I've got a back injury. Or if it's just something you do right to get the flow going, everything like that, relax the muscles. Nice right hand right there.
Oh, and this looks like it's going to be a striking bout right now.
I just like the patience of Resendez's way. He steps in, closes that distance, and fires that straight right hand.
Right now, Jackson really leading with that right. Looking kind of flashy up there, kind of almost a dance karate stance, wide stance. It's a good body kick. Ooh, good right. I'm sorry, a left. Front high kick, very active right now.
Yeah, these kicks, that's the one thing you gotta work for. They're doing a good job of keeping each other from closing the distance with those legs. I love the range. Righty versus lefty, see, stepping outside, firing that straight right to a lefty. That's the way you want to do it.
And you're wondering if Resendez is going to find the timing where he actually is able to grab onto one. He almost did right there. Ooh, he returned with a big kick. And Santonio Jackson ate that well. Ooh, another big kick.
Big shot. Got the quadzilla going on. Crazy, man. These kids coming in this cage first and second time looking good, man.
They're punching just too far out. As soon as he can close that distance a little bit, and then on the counter, his left hand was just missing the right and the left.
He know, Jackson is bringing those hands up every time he's close, but every time he feels like he's out of range, he's lowering them quite a bit.
Could be dangerous. That sweet chin music.
The hesitation just on that counter. Catch the leg, fires that right, if he just gets step off. If he can just get in just a little bit, that right's there.
There he caught that kick finally.
The second time seems like he's done that.
You know, watching bullfighters, I'd really like to see some lower leg kicks. There you go, there right there. There you go, good right.
He caught him. Drops level, goes in for the takedown.
Well, you can see that opened up that right hand. Up and another right. Jackson looks like he's maybe a little hurt. The mouth's open.
The mouth is open. That's a telltale, right? He's looking for air, not comfortable having that mouthpiece in. And again, you look at the weight, those kicks are just missing. He's got to be careful as we get tired, right? See the hands starting to drop.
Yes.
Left, right misses. Another right. Ooh, that right hits from Zendes.
Zendes looks like he did some cupping.
Yeah, it doesn't look like he has an injury. I think the biggest thing is you can see as the confidence starts to grow. If he can just get in, he's just missing that right hand.
Ooh, good right there from Jackson. Ooh, good body kick. Now that's a close round, but I've got to give it to Resendez. I felt he was just a little bit more successful with his strikes, less wild, and he connected a little bit more, especially with those head kicks. He hit two of those head kicks that I've got to give Santonio Jackson credit for. He ate them like a hoagie sandwich.
Yeah. He did. And
well, that's
for
the one thing with Jackson, he's got to be careful. He is a little winded, and you know, but you can tell he wants to scrap. He wants to get in and just kind of just let it all hang out.
Yeah.
I mean, he starts throwing a lot. You can tell with the way that they're kicking, throwing the combination. But I'm not sure if he's going to try to be a little leady, you know what I mean? Hesitant, trying to get back, take a breath in his mouth. He's really tired. He's seeing it.
He looks like he's got some length on Resendez, too, so you would think he'd take a little bit more advantage of it. But like you said, you know, fatigue makes cowards out of men, and it gets dangerous, man. You get way more susceptible to getting tagged.
But I know he wants to. You can tell he wants to fight. He just doesn't have the gas in the tank on a short notice.
He's breathing heavy back
big
there.
Big time, big time. Mouth is wide open.
And if you saw that first minute, his style was a lot flashier in that first minute when they were trading. Let's see what we got going on right here. Hands are high.
Oh, Jackson gets shot to the back of the head. Big kick to the back of the head. It's like you said, Bermas, Jackson ate it like a hoagie.
You know, that one was the first one that put him down and bent him over a little bit. I'm impressed he got up as well as he did.
Toughness right there from Antonio Jackson.
The question is, though, is if he can come in and land a 1-2, a body shot, and leave that head wide open and hit flush, is he going to be able to eat him like that? Almost nobody can. Oh, good leg kick right there. Like that in the movement. And now you're seeing Santonio Jackson kind of wing those punches with his mouth wide open.
Yeah, I saw a little kind of, not really a back fist, but just throwing the punch very technically unsound, if you will.
Well, there's just not a lot of setup there, right there. You know, that's almost a reactionary punch with nothing on it. And you're looking right now, Resendez is starting to see that. He's crowding him more and more. He's putting him right up against that cage.
He needs to crowd him. After he does the 1-2 to get in, I'd like to see him stay in.
There's nice,
and that
right?
Second and third shot would be the ones that are really going to hurt him.
Jackson, they're slipping a couple of those punches when he was up against the cage there.
Look, this fight isn't over.
No.
If Jackson can land one of those head kicks, it could put him to sleep. Good left, right there. That one got him. He's off to his side. He's still a little stung by that.
Oh, big left. Straight shot there from Jackson.
Hands are extremely low. Left, right.
Good shot.
Oh, like you said, JB, this fight is not over.
That's the one thing about Jackson. Like I said, if he just had gas in the tank, he's got a lot of fight in him.
Well, like Jason just mentioned, man, the setups, they're just not there. Just winging him.
Took it on 3 days' notice.
I'm not mad at him.
But he's trying to land those counter shots, and it is working. He's frustrated with Resendez, without a doubt, landing those shots. And that's one thing where Resendez would just stay inside and just go, now, where's the second, third shots? Chase on there.
That turning the back, too.
Exactly. Jackson's got to watch himself from turning fully to his back and basically having the fight called. You know you can't turn your back in MMA because you have to defend yourself at all times. Good right hand. Jackson's still in this. Front kick, right hand.
Without a doubt.
And I think Resendez realized he can't get too sloppy. There was a big breath by Resendez right there. Good body here, kick.
Nice big counter right hand from Resendez.
Good uppercut by Resendez.
Nice combination.
Oh, he's really hurting him. He's got shots to the body. This could be it. He's cleared it in.
Resendez is
body shot, body shot, headshot, body shot.
Big knee. Wow, the tenacity of these kids, man. Wow.
Great fight so far.
How would you score that round, boys?
I'm still giving it to Resendez. You know, there was a bit of a moral victory for Santonio Jackson, not getting finished by that last combo and getting the takedown. But, you know, this is it. He's got to find that one big shot. You know, he needs that big kick. He needs that big knee. And he's really got to watch himself when he's getting hit with that left-right combo. It's that right hand on the second shot that keeps getting to turn his head.
That's always so dangerous when I see fighters turn away like that.
And there it is again, the left-right right there, and then he turns his head. You know, and there's a kick afterwards, and you can see his hands are gone. There it is, a left-right again.
Brock Lesnar used to have a terrible trait.
And there's the left-right again.
I know no one likes to get punched in the face, but you got, like you said, JB, you got to defend yourself at all times. But, again, this fight is not over. There's a lot of fight in both these
and
boys.
And here's the flurry right here that could have ended it, and instead ends with a takedown, point of a moral victory for Jackson. Good
Without
for him.
A doubt. Resendez was throwing everything at him right there in that last barrage, but Jackson had enough wherewithal to put Resendez on his back.
Hey, Jackson got a little bit more love. He went from 31% to 36%.
There you go. Pulse. Closing the gap.
Three more minutes. Here we go.
Jackson's mouth staying open, though.
Oh, he's breathing big time heavy. And they tap in the middle of the cage. Here we go. Final round.
See, he's got what it takes. This final third round in our second bout of the evening. Cage aggression 33. The trifecta is underway.
Body kick right there. Oh, he's winging it.
That was a big right hook that he just winged, like you said.
Body kick to the left side there. Up. Resendez coming in. Success in the strike. Good
There's
leg kick.
That
there
kick.
Was. Look at that. That low leg kick opened up that right hand.
It sure
hand.
Did. It sure did.
Antonio Jackson returning
nice
rights. Another right. Tell you what, though, that left hand is really, really low.
Ooh, and he just got tagged with Resendez's right hand.
Exactly. That hand is low. And again, left right. That hurt.
Unloading right here in front of us.
That's her landing. Big knee to the body. Oh, my goodness. Another big knee to the body. The knee. Oh, that's it.
Referee Bruce Allen step in. He's seen enough.
And I don't think that was a bad call. You know, you looked at he didn't complain. Antonio Jackson looks like he's out of breath. It doesn't look like he'd be able to defend himself right now. Those were three very big knees to the body.
A lot of unanswered
and
punches.
And what a scrap.
Without a doubt. That was a good fight, boys.
Fun
damn
fight.
Good fight.
Really good fight. I would love to see this kid in shape. I would love to see him with the camp. Jackson, that is.
Yeah.
I would love to see what he can do.
Love to see him set up some of them shots a little better, utilize his length to his advantage a little bit more. But the kid's tough, without a doubt. No doubt of it.
I like that Resendez. He noticed and he seen that it was time to, if he just put in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 punches, it was time to put him away. So he just turned on the gas and went ham.
Last time, got put on his back, though. So.
I know, that's what I mean. So he knew it was time to do it again, but this time, it paid off.
Without a doubt. Two fights so far, two finishes. With more to come.
And we're watching the replay of the end right here. These brutal uppercuts into the knees. One knee, uppercut, uppercut, two knees, three knees. Up, and then we cut it back again there. But the guy got 4 or 5 in there, 3 in a row before.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Bruce Allen, has called a stop to this contest at 1:02 into round 3, declaring your winner by TKO, Juan Resendez. Come on over, Juan. Hey, first of all, I want to tell you congratulations on the big win for your caged aggression debut, man. Tell us how you're feeling right now.
I've been happy for a while now, ever since I got the fight. I'm like a tourist getting inside perspective, you know?
Hey, tourist, look, this wasn't the opponent that you had originally planned on. What kind of new challenges did Santonio present to you?
Well, for one thing, I didn't know who he was, what he looked like. up until the last minute, but other than that, we just really stuck to the same game plan.
Did you know, you got a big stoppage, very tough opponent. Tell us what's around the corner for you, Juan.
Hopefully another fight as soon as possible. You know, I'm gonna fight as often as, you know, once a month. That's too much to ask probably, but you know, that's all I want.
Well, look, I know there's gonna be a lot of eyes on you following your career. Anything you wanna add to this?
Yeah, shout out to Halo Exteriors, our guy Richard, very good sponsor. Hit our hands, you know what I mean? And he's a good guy. My other sponsors as well, you know. That's all.
All right, well, hey, we're definitely looking forward to your next trip to the Canva Cage. But until then, let's hear it one more time, ladies and gentlemen, for your winner tonight, Juan Resendez.
Impressive W picked up by Juan Resendez as we move into our third bout of the evening. Zach Pridemore versus Marshall Kremenek. As Zach Pridemore makes his way into the cage, aggression cage. Fighting out of St. Joseph. Got into MMA through Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, which he got into out of high school. Thoughts on his matchup? His opponent is a mystery to him, but that's part of the experience. Some of his strengths he feels are experience in jiu-jitsu and obvious his boxing and striking. It's pretty great too, he says. Looks up to Anthony Showtime Pettis, no stranger to the cage aggression cage, or the UFC cage for that matter. He's been his favorite fighter of all time. Boxer Mike Tyson, Vasily Lomachenko, The Matrix, has impacted him as well. Reason his name is The Mosquito is because one of his gym's black belts would call fighting less experienced people annoying, as if they were getting harder to beat and it was like a mosquito. There we go.
I just love his last name. Pridemore.
All right.
The Mosquito. I love it. I love it. And it's funny.
See, I would be going with like Zach Poundsmore Pridemore. You know what I'm saying? Like, but that's just me. Looking very, very serious as he talks to his coaches one last time before his opponent enters into the cage.
And here he comes, Marshall Kremenek, fighting out of Cedar Rapids. He enjoys competition and wanted a way to outlet his feelings. Once again, channeling his energy into something positive. He knows it will be a good fight. He's looking forward to it. Not afraid to scrap, have a brawl. Looking for a slobber knocker. He looks up to his coaches, Eric Coach and Juan Roman. We've seen both of those guys. Juan Roman, Jens, you might remember that gentleman. He's the one who did the spinning heel kick on somebody we'll be seeing later this weekend, Michael the Battleship. You dropped a little expletive and that went viral. Went to Business Insider, Apple News, the whole nine.
Yeah, every now and then something, yeah. Hey. When it brings the cuss word out, you know, it was quite amazing.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm still stuck on Pridemore, than anything. That's going to be his, that should be his name, is than anything. So Pridemore than anything.
There you go. That's another good one. I mean, the mosquito's fun, right?
The mosquito's beautiful.
It's not quite as intimidating as, you know, like the anvil or the hammer, but
Skeeter.
Hey, he'll get in there and get the job done.
That's right. Games don't matter
exactly.
If the job gets done.
Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, our third bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Bantamweight Division, powered by Iowa Auto Club West. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands an even 6 feet tall and weighed in at 136 pounds. He trains at CU MMA and Fitness. Joining us from Urbana, Illinois, Zach Pridemore. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5 feet, 8 inches tall and weighed in at 130 pounds. He trains at Regulators Fight Team. Joining us from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Marshall Kremenek.
Hey,
in popping. Zach Pridemore and Marshall Kremenek. About ready to scrap.
And Pridemore is coming in as the favorite by almost 65% to 35 against Kremenek. Here we go.
Pridemore dropping a quick 1-2 on the Mosquito in the opening moments here.
Going after that single, looking to pick it up. We got a little cage hold. Oh, oh, the ref ripped it away. Now he's going to give up his back. Keep that hip down, keep that hip down. Wade, hold on to the head, get back to his feet. Nice job. Up again, nice takedown, good single. Got to watch the hip. Trying to head over.
Nice reversal there from Kremenek. I'm sorry, Pridemore.
Oh, now he pops out.
Kremenek on his back like this is very bad. He's got both hooks in, and he's got a lot of control and a lot of time.
Flattened out.
No bueno.
Not good at all. Let's see where he goes with this.
Kremenek looking to make short work of the Mosquito here.
Oh, he's got to watch it.
Careful with that back of the head.
Good job of getting, you know, back to on his back, but he's in a really bad spot
here.
Yeah.
Looking to step off to
we
the
could
side,
be seeing the second
and he has
one.
Stepped off.
Level.
It's in there.
Oh,
it's
that
in
could
there.
Be just about it, folks.
All the energy in the world. These open moments of the first round. What's a good counter for that, Coach?
Well, it doesn't look like he's trying to tighten up. It looks like he's lost it.
He let it go.
Yeah, it's the biggest thing, right? Answer the phone. Try to, get that loose spot. He's got to be careful with the armbar right here.
There it is.
Definitely trying to get that arm.
Doing what he can to hold on and keep from extending it, getting it popped out.
Plenty of time. Minute 30 seconds left in round number one.
This would be a good time now with that right hand. Start throwing shots, goes back into the mount.
Oh, and he's landing here. That's a good right there. Pridemore trying to cover up, but he's high on that mount.
Kremenek's a little high, going for that triangle once again.
Inverted triangle, he's going to go with the arm. He's got him all knotted up, but.
Nice technique there from Kremenek.
Third submission attempt right here.
Absolutely.
Going from one to
good
another.
Good job of coming around, but.
Nice transition.
Oh, you got to be careful with that arm.
Oh, he's got it.
But he's still rolling around.
Still turned. Oh, he looks like it's a little bit more straight.
It's in there.
It's good, but is he going to finish it? He's putting it under the arm. That's uncomfortable. Oh, my goodness.
And Mosquito doing a nice job of defending against that.
Really good job. We've got an omoplata and an arm bar.
Wow.
All at the same time. Got him all tied up.
All sorts of chain jujitsu. They talk about chain wrestling.
Yeah.
This guy's gone
from
one sub into another sub into another sub.
30 seconds left.
Almost looking for like a Kimura type thing here.
Rolls it. Wow. GG to hang on. Nice job. Ends up in the mount, but good Lord. Kremenek.
One shot, two shots.
Kremenek is tougher than nails.
Oh, man, just landing.
Dropping the shot. Less than five seconds left. He'll make it out of this first round, it looks like. Going for that arm triangle a little bit once again.
Oh, my Lord.
Wow, what a first round. Action packed.
Well, I'm serious. I can't believe the toughness of Kremenek. You kept getting in. Or just Pridemore with the transition, You know what I mean? Had the mount, had the arm bars, had the triangle, had an omoplata arm bar-ish, all happening at the same time. I mean, he threw everything at Kremenek. Kitchen sinked him. And Kremenek still
tough nails.
Was over there. Really tough.
This is one of those rare fights where both guys have a similar skin tone and no tattoos and black trunks. So actually when they're up here, I'm like, where are we at? So it's the beard against the goatee. That's where it's at.
What's our poll looking like?
Right now, Pridemore's still in the lead by almost 65%. The question is, what do you do to turn this thing around? You dominated the first round. Do you just try to keep it on the feet? Do you try to get your strikes off? You try to go for the takedown at the mount.
Make small adjustments, and that's, I mean, again, his toughness is there. He's got to figure out what was the game plan. What are you working on? What have you been training? And that's what you got to do. Like, he tries to get in there, step in, throw that shot. Got kicked a little low.
The jiblies. Close to the jiblies.
Ooh,
Kremenek
good right.
Got hit there.
Ooh, nice body shot into a right. Wow. It's like Pridemore reversed from all the submissions into a striker all of a sudden.
There you go. Jack of all trades over here.
Kremenek with his back up against the cage. Pridemore, both hooks around him.
Yes. Kremenek delivering some shots, defending well. He is now on his back, right here in front of us in the broadcast booth. Pridemore with half guard, looks like.
step over that leg.
Skeeter slowly working this position here.
Now, Jens Pulver, he's got one leg over. What are you encouraging him to do? To try to step over fully, ground and pound? Where would you like him to go from
here? Yeah, I would love to see him flatten him out right here. As he's trying to go over the corner, just push him out. But you got him up against the fence. Utilize right there. Face up against the fence. Look how uncomfortable he is. Sit up. Take your time. Biggest thing, take your time. And just start throwing one shot at a time. Push down on that face. Land one, two blasts. Let him direct where he wants to go.
Transition into the arm bar.
His back against the cage, who couldn't get the full extension. He's moved into a little better position now to execute that armbar. Now,
Kremenek really doing, you know, a decent job defending, but he's finding himself in all sorts of bad positions.
Yeah, he's just
every time
out of the frying pan into the fire over and over and over. But I mean, he is tough as nails. He is tough as nails. I just don't get. But now, he just doesn't have no direction. You know what I mean? He's just trying to hold on for dear life. It's like the inevitable is coming.
You going for Anaconda there? Or would it...
About a reverse head and arm almost, and then he's got it turned around a little bit. I don't know how deep it is.
It'd be Conda-ish if now he just got to lay sideways, get cup to cup, make that squeeze, or once again, he's able to put a knee on the stomach, start looking to do some damage. See, again, Kremenek is fighting from all over the place.
Yeah, he is.
He's getting squeezed down. He's getting just dominated. But there's no fight. I mean, there's no quitting.
So he stepped over rather easily there. What I would have loved to see first is a couple knees to the side. Those were wide open. He's doing well on these strikes. Oh, how much time we got here? 35 seconds left. Pridemore in dominant fashion.
Without
again.
A doubt. Now, without a doubt.
Now, maybe you argue that the first round isn't a 10-8, right? Not totally dominant. Only, even though we saw three submission attempts, we saw another two, possibly three right here, submission attempts, a little bit more striking, really no offense other than from the bottom momentarily from Pridemore. Can this Jens Pulver make a 10-8 round?
This should be a 10-8. They like to throw them out there every now and then, but this should be 10-8 is pretty much all the time. He's trying to lock up. You look, going for the simple, looking to grab that rear neck choke. And again, I'm telling you what, man, Kremenek, his survivability is just ridiculous.
Tough kid, without a doubt.
Ridiculous. Could you imagine if somewhere down the road you gave this kid some direction and you gave him the ability, you know what I mean, the ideas of throwing knee shots and tightening up his game? He's already got the toughness, good Lord.
And it's a tale of two corners right now. I'm looking at Pridemore. He looks confident. He looks fresh. He's listening to the coaches. And I'm looking across the way, and unfortunately, Kremenek looking a little dejected.
Yes.
Eric Koch, one of the best coaches in the game, UFC veteran himself. If you're Eric Koch right now, what are you telling your fighter? You got to win this. You got to have a finish. How does he do it?
You know, and that's the problem is I just don't see the tools there. I would tell him patience, be busier with the hands when you do, like throw longer punches, you know what I mean? But he's just getting smothered, he's getting caught, and he scrambles.
All over him.
Another big, big, big deep breath from Kremenek across the cage.
Land a big shot.
That's pretty much what he's got so far, because Pridemore's jiu-jitsu is just, when they get the ground, man.
There's a one, two, opening
he
comes
up.
Out, I like it.
Kremenek coming out.
Oh, and he's firing.
Don't lean back so much when Pridemore is coming in, so that way you got off balance when he gets in there. Fight the hands, peel these off, stand back up.
Woke Pridemore up.
Yeah, it did. You wasn't going to coast a victory on this Kremenek kid.
I don't know that anybody's going to coast a victory against this Kremenek kid.
Yeah, he's tough, man. He's real tough.
Oh, wow.
Fight the hands, peel back, try to figure out how to get back up.
Get his back here. Try to put those hooks in.
He's done just a really, real, really great job of not allowing much space, if any, on the ground. Just once he's there, okay, I'm on top. Maybe I have to go to the side. But if I'm up on your back, I'm right up against it. I'm going to make sure to put those hooks in. And right now he's got two. Oh, he's trapping the arm.
Well, that's what Kremenek is getting in trouble with, is because everything is so tight. He needs to find some space. He's just getting smothered the entire time by Pridemore, and that's the issue. If he could somehow get that space and create the scrambles, he's proven he's in shape. You know what I mean? He's got the ability, but he's just, Pridemore's just on him and just stuck to him.
Kremenek turning into him, trying to turn into him there.
You know, if I had anything to say to Pride more, it's you have all the tools, work on those finishes. Work on those last moments of getting that choke, of pulling that arm, of laying that body triangle in so you can get under the chin. Even right
he's
now,
right
he's
there.
Under the chin
he's
here.
Under it.
This could be it. That's it. Dolly,
no, he's going out. I think he's going out. Can, and Kremnak is throwing punches.
I know, it's crazy.
Just won't go no easy.
I don't see him tapping. I see him getting put to sleep.
He's going Kremnak. Kremnak's still fighting this. And Pridemore does another great job of trapping that arm. I mean, my goodness.
Yeah, kid's jiu-jitsu's on point. Very point well taken there, JB. He's been in so many dominant positions and positions to finish, but just not closing the deal.
And you know what? That might not be his fault. I mean, this kid is
I was
going
to say,
tough.
He's about to lock up both arms. Oh, now he's got there. Both arms locked up with the rear naked choke. The kid can't even tap.
It's under there.
Kremnak is so tough. That is the one issue.
He's
I
got
can't...
the arm isolated. I'm sorry, champ.
No,
arm isolated. Under the chin. Game up on
it. He got out of it. I can't.
Man, Kremnak's
okay.
tough as hell.
Kremnak is single-handedly the toughest kid I've ever seen, and I'm saying it that way, seen ever. Now it's just how do you? Now we got to give this kid some direction, give him some skill sets, and let him get some confidence when
bar.
He gets out there. But I've never seen anything as tough as he is.
And you know what? I love the fact that Pridemore goes for one final submission.
There you go.
You know, what a fun fight.
And another transition from armbar to here, omoplata to here.
Oh, transition from one to the next,
wow.
One to the next. And it, again, because of the toughness of Kremnak, we got to see Pridemore rip off one self, transition to another self, convert to this, trap an arm, look for the rear naked. And we witnessed a whole bunch, but good Lord. That kid is tough.
You know, Zach Pridemore in this fight.
Air Coach just said he's a tough MF-er.
Yes, he is.
I've never seen nothing like it. I'm stunned.
Pridemore really reminded me of an early Nate Diaz. Because Nate Diaz was one of those guys that had that chain jiu-jitsu, and it would go from one submission transition into another, and we just got a treat. Anybody that loves the ground game is going to love rewatching this fight.
Absolutely.
Anybody who loves watching a tough kid not give up is going to love this fight and love Cage Aggression.
Even though he's going to pick up the L, sometimes when you lose, you really win. Rosie Perez said
all goes. I'm saying, Kremnak, when he gets his direction and sticks with this game and figures it out, the hardest part he's already got. His toughness, his courage, his heart. I've never seen nothing like it. I can't stop staring at it. He just won in my eyes because what you can do with that, oh my Lord.
This is what we come to expect here from Cage Aggression MMA. Incredible matchups, incredible battles, whether they're seasoned veterans or new to the game. This is what we do around here.
I can't believe he got out of all of those. I just can't believe it. And again, props to Pridemore. He did a phenomenal job of one after the other.
Yes.
But again, it got to the point where that's why all I do is watch Kremnak. Like, he literally got out of everything. My man had a rear naked choke with both arms pinched off in the leg. And he still somehow wiggled his way out of it.
Got all the arm triangle, got all the omoplatas, got all the arm, yeah.
He Houdini'd everything. Serious. I can't believe, good Lord.
That needs to be his new nickname.
And Eric Koch is actually smiling as fighter. All cheers in that corner.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. I'm smiling over for him because the pluses I just witnessed, you can't, there's nothing you can do. You either have that or you don't. That kid has got to be the toughest kid literally I've seen in a long time. I can't believe it. Hopefully he keeps the confidence. I mean, hopefully he keeps the you know, I mean, he doesn't get too disheartened on this and he goes out there and he just trains and sharpens his tools. Because good Lord, man, it's unreal.
I think his coaches are echoing your sentiments here, champ, in the corner with him.
Ladies and gentlemen, we go to the judges' scorecard for our decision. Our judges scored this contest 30-27, 30-27, and 30-24, declaring your winner by unanimous decision, Zach Pridemore. Come over here, Zach. All right, first of all, man, congratulations on the win. Never an easy fight in the Kama cage. Talk to us about that fight a little bit.
Well, first of all, a lot of respect to Kremnak for stepping up when my last opponent pulled out. Holy crap, that guy is tough. His submission defense defies all logic. I've got a ton of respect for him.
Well, that was going to be one thing I was going to ask you. You had him in a couple tough spots all throughout the fight, man. Did it ever get discouraging to you at any point?
Oh, when he wasn't tapping to those arm bars, I got very discouraged. I mean, I've been doing jiu-jitsu for a long time. It doesn't make sense when the arm goes back that far and he's not tapping to me.
So what did I leave out? What did I miss here?
Say that again?
What did I leave out? What did I miss? Anything you want to add? Anyone you want to thank?
No, not really. I think it's pretty clear what happened, how tough he is and how tough I am. You know, great show.
For sure. Wouldn't disagree with any of that. Let us know what's around the corner.
Well, I definitely want to fight again, make my parents nervous one more time at least. My dad was probably pacing again somewhere around here. But yeah, definitely more fights for me probably.
Well, we're definitely looking forward to it. Lots of great scrambles in this last one. Entertaining from bell to bell. Looking forward to it. But let's hear it, ladies and gentlemen. One more time for your winner tonight, Zach Pridemore.
Wow, what an incredible fight we just witnessed, ladies and gentlemen. Zach Pridemore picking up a very tough contested victory over Marshall Krimenak. As we move into our next bout, Nick Ramey versus Alex Lunin. Nick Ramey makes his way to the cage, aggression cage. Out of Davenport, Iowa, says he's done this since he was knee high in the game, since he was potty trained. This is his first paid for fight. Feels his brain power is the difference maker. Any role models or people he looks up to in the sport? No. Says he's fought over 100 times and didn't get paid for it once, so he's entering into the payday days. On a worldwide platform, Cage Aggression MMA, cageaggression.tv. Thank you all for joining us on pay-per-view throughout the globe. Yeah, like you said, champ, that Marshall Krimenak has nothing to be ashamed of. That was quite a fight, man.
I'm still thinking about it. Think about that. I mean, you're just like, could you imagine? I mean, that kid was so tough. Oh, I couldn't believe it. Never gave up.
Show up and fight while we were still doing tournaments, so I didn't have anybody. At one point they're like, hey, you got gear? Yeah, fight.
And
so
in that area,
we fight
the videotape. So
yeah, it's crazy.
It must be so hard to just find videotape. I mean, actual VHS videotape.
Yeah, we literally VHS to Blu-ray. He had no idea. He just fought people. I didn't care.
Betamax back in the day.
Yeah, there was no YouTuber.
But like you said, kind of alluded to a moment ago, champ, I mean, if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. And you guys always were on your square.
And that's it, because you never know. That opportunity can come a calling. It can be 1 week out. If you're ready, you're climbing that ladder, you're climbing that
ladder. Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for three-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Middleweight Division, powered by Stand and Protect. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, He stands 5'9" tall and weighed in at 187 pounds. Joining us from Davenport, Iowa, Nick Ramey. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5'10" tall and weighed in at 181 pounds. Joining us from Woodhull, Illinois, Alex Doonan.
Alex Doonan, Nick Ramey, getting ready to do it.
And Doonan actually coming in the favorite at almost 55%, but pretty down the middle. It looks like it's a catchweight bout, 181 and 187, so somewhere around middleweight. Could be an exciting fight.
Uh-oh, Doonan. Whoa, jeez! Nick Ramey with a big takedown.
Doonan ran right in there.
Yeah,
just
he
did. Ramey, go here, take this takedown.
They're ready to get after it.
Well, he needs to make sure he's trying the other direction.
Oh, Doonan swinging for the fences.
He's ready to do it.
Oh, big left. Those are big shots. Oh. This could be over early, guys. He's getting to his feet.
He's about to get picked up again.
The boy's coming out banging.
All right, Ramey, you got to just kind of sit back, slow down. There you go.
He's looking a little uncomfortable down there, isn't he, Jens?
Yeah, Doonan's got to figure out again. He's stuck in a bad spot. If Ramey would just slow down, stay heavy, stay down towards the hips. There, that's all you got to do right there. Just throw the shots, nowhere else to go. It's time for Doonan to move. Then he lets him go. All right.
And he said, let's get back to our feet, and here we are in the middle of the cage.
Ooh, good kick.
Ooh. Inside leg kick there from Doonan. Ooh. Get that mouthpiece in your mouth, bro.
Well, good body kick.
Oh, he's got to keep those hands up, especially as the opponent's coming closer.
I was going to say, Ramey has got those hands really low, although he had the offensive success in the beginning. They weren't just striking on the feet.
Ooh.
And here he is again going for that takedown. He's around his back.
Set it up with a nice little quick short right jab.
Trying to chip him down. Good hand fighting by Doonan. Got to be careful. Doonan thinking, he's thinking guillotine already.
Yes, he might lock that in.
He might get it tight. He might get, all right, well.
Well, let's see where it goes from here.
I don't
it's not
see
the best
Ramey
position.
Yet. Ramey's not exactly fighting it free yet.
No.
He's still under the body lock. Nah.
It's not locked in. It's not under the chin. But I got to tell you, Ramey doesn't look that comfortable right now.
Yeah, what he needs to work on right now is, again, Doonan's got to make sure he doesn't hold on to this until he's in a bad position, like half guard, like full mount. He's got to work from right here and start trying to utilize that as a handle to improve your position. There you go. Start to work your way up. Don't let go of the head. You're going to have to post with something.
And Ramey on top. Oop. Shots are sneaking into the face right there.
I like that. That's exactly. You got nowhere to go. Sit right there, Ramey, and just throw shots.
And he's doing a good job of taking his left hand and pushing down Doonan's right hand as he's getting those shots in. And right now his left hand a little bit around that neck, but he's not looking for any type of a finish or a sub. And here come those shots again.
Now he's going to try to throw the left leg in. He's going to try to throw doubles.
Yeah, we'll
one
see.
One in, holding that position.
He is throwing those lefts like crazy.
Doonan trying to get back to his feet. Ooh.
He's got about
back,
7 seconds to lock it in. It's already tapped out with 5 seconds left in the fight.
Ramey! GG. GG.
Wow. Impressive first round and picking up the W with seconds left in the round.
Got under there, got it tight, got the quick tap.
That was impressive. He's only exploded on him.
You know, there's some fundamentals he's going to have to work on, but he's got some brute strength, some decent striking, and he's got the finish.
It worked. Both these guys came out ready to scrap. Nick Ramey picking up a very quick, short work. Mr. Alex Doonan. Alex Doonan still, he got a smile on his face, it's interesting. Having a good time in there, all these fighters.
I don't know how big my smile would be if
that's
I just
big.
I'm still trying. I'm trying to figure out the Doonan vibe right now. I'm trying to figure out what he's got, what he's all about. He's got me tripping. I'm just looking at him. He's like, eh, whatever, you know. He's just nonchalant.
Chilling. So he's going to corn tomorrow
he
night.
Looked, the thing is, he literally looked like that before the fight. He had, right. There's not much changing.
Winner lost. He's cheesing.
All smiles in the cage.
Doing
you gotta
what you love
that.
Doing what you love.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Josh Stewart, has called a stop to this contest at 2 minutes, 55 seconds into round one, declaring your winner by submission due to rear naked choke, Nick Ramey. All right, Nick, come on over. First of all, man, congratulations on the win. Never easy coming in. Last minute change as far as opponents go. What did that do, if anything, to your game plan tonight?
It was just different. I was suspecting one person, but hey, you know, I trained. I'm still out of breath, though. I just plan on being better next time.
Well, hey, you got a tough or a good win over a tough opponent tonight. Anything you want to add or anyone you want to thank before I let you get back to the locker room?
Yeah, I want to thank all you people for showing up. I want to thank Mike Goodwin for this opportunity. And I want to thank the next opponent.
All right. Well, hey, we're going to let you get back, start the celebration, and catch your breath a little bit. But before that, I want everyone one more time, let's hear it for your winner tonight, Nick Ramey.
Yep, impressive first round victory from Nick Ramey as we move into our next fight. Nick Woodford going up against Zach Price. Nick Woodford coming out to the cage first, fighting out of Dell's Pro Gym out of DeWitt, Iowa. Always been a fan since he was young and became involved in wrestling. He has no real thoughts on his matchup, just here to promote violence. Feels that his lengthy wrestling background and has a very tough mentality will be the difference maker. Looks up to a couple guys. I don't know if you've heard of him, Jens, or not. His name is Jens Pulver and Matt Hughes.
And that's why I love him.
Getting ready to get in the cage and do work. Speaking of smiling, JB, one of your favorite fighters who's always smiling. We're going to be seeing sometime this weekend. The Beefcake himself, Jordan Crowers.
Saw him weigh in today. I couldn't be more excited for that scrap tomorrow night. But we got this one, Nick!
That's right. Can't get ahead of ourselves as Nick Woodford and Zach Price. We're getting ready to get on the good foot and do the big thing around here.
And by the way, if you're a Woodford guy, I'd encourage you to get over on the polls because right now he is the underdog at 40%, but closing in on Zach Price as we speak.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah.
Ryan Delph, no stranger to the cage aggression cage. Has his gym here and his cigar bar here in the Quad City.
And we're in that gorilla.
And Wonder is having.
He is a gorilla. Very, very nice gentleman in person.
Ryan's awesome. This is not our last fight, but our last fight before our intermission. As Nick Woodford steps into the cage, getting ready to do damage as he wants to promote violence this evening. And there's been no shortage of it. As his opponent, Zach Price, makes his way to the cage, aggression cage. Ran a karate school when Eric Coach introduced him to MMA. Thoughts on the matchup? He'll be a good one for his first, another first timer, stepping into the cage. Feels that his striking and his BJJ will be the difference maker and looks up to the one and only Steven Wonderboy Thompson. It's a good one to look up to.
Very good.
I've had the pleasure of interviewing him a few times, man. It's a really cool guy, man. Loved watching him back in the World Combat League days, that Chuck Norris outfit.
You know, and he's had quite the resurgence in his career. There's still the possibility that Steven Wonderboy Thompson could be a champion. He's a top five, top 10 guy all the time. His striking really hasn't degraded an inch.
No.
And a lot of guys don't want to step in there with that awkward karate style.
Without a doubt.
He has always been my pick when it comes to Usman. Some of that would be fun to watch him fight because he would force a lot of movement.
Yeah.
Usman's too dang good. He's too solid. He's like a Mack truck going 50 miles an hour. But the way that
the Wonder Boy could move around, it would force him. I would like to see him have to get out of that pocket.
Yeah. He's been very, very successful in negating some of those wrestlers and keeping that karate distance.
It's all that movement and keeping that distance. And the only way you're going to find him is you got to go after him.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Lightweight Division, powered by Yabba Dabba's House of Glass. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 5'9" tall and weighed in at 154 pounds. He trains at Delft's Pro Gym and Crew Delicious. Joining us from Iowa City, Iowa, Nick Woodford. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands at even 6 feet tall and weighed in at 152 pounds. He trains with Regulators Fight Team. Joining us from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Zach Bryce.
I like that, a redhead with a red stripe right on the shorts. These guys look like they're ready to go.
Yeah, I don't see this one going the distance, boys. I could be wrong, but this one might be a quickie.
A lot of mean intentions in both guys' faces
right now. I'm seeing it.
I'm telling you, first 30 seconds.
Price coming out loose.
Good front kick there from Price.
Goes for the head kick, looking to be the aggressor. A little sloppy with that spin kick. Got to watch that.
Yeah, Woodard takes advantage of that. Got him on his back. Got Price on his back here.
Woodford on top.
See if Woodford can take advantage.
Oh, nice slam. Nice slam. Tell you what, Price trying to go for that arm right afterwards. Oh, he's caught open.
He is cut. He's leaking.
Got a cut. Wow, Price is slam.
Leaking. Price still coming out aggressive.
I like Price's right front kick there, setting up some of these other strikes.
Now, when there's so much action like this in less than a minute, we've been 40 seconds. Are you more or less likely, Jens, to have that adrenaline dump?
Oh, you're going to have a semi-adrenaline dump. It's just a matter of, right? You see, starting to clean the eyes off. But I just don't see Price slowing down with those kicks.
Look at that. He's got
Woodford. Yeah, he's got Woodford reaching from a long ways away. Keep that distance. If you can just slow it down and utilize, Price needs to just utilize that range like he's doing with those feet. Especially, Woodford is having a hard time trying to close that distance.
Which of them strikes up is Price.
Tell you what, Price looks extremely calm in there, even though he's got a little more wear and tear on his face.
Ooh, nice spinning heel kick there from Price.
That got through.
It did. Didn't quite land flush, but it definitely got his attention. Got Woodford's attention. Woodard's attention, I'm sorry.
Woodard on top Woodard right now. Going to town. Got to watch
well,
it.
See, now he's got the arm bar.
He got it.
First
for him.
And you see, that was that power. The power and, like you said, the adrenaline of the first time through when he went up and he muscled and he was able to slam him down. You know it was a matter of time, but I'm telling you, Price, keeping his composure with those strikes and his ground game, he was deadly.
Zach Price came out to game time, dude. He came out to do it. Got cut early. Versatile, very versatile with his strikes.
Hey, that was a very exciting 90 seconds in MMA right there.
Without a doubt.
Well, I always say the first 30 seconds, but that's, you know, first 30 seconds. But if you notice, you actually did get to see the adrenaline that first. After that minute, it kind of slowed down, and it really was in Price's favor. Landing those long-range kicks, waiting for Woodford to try to get in there and get that takedown. And as soon as he did, he knew this time he was going to be able to transition because you can't powerbomb out of everything.
Yeah.
No, you can't. And Price maintained his composure. I would say he took a couple deep breaths and remained composed. He didn't even need those deep breaths. You know, you're seeing one bloodied-up happy fighter right
100.
Now. Watching this, here it is, wrapping that up, going for it.
Ladies and gentlemen,
always active from
your
the bottom.
Referee Bruce Allen has called a stop to this contest at 1 minute, 31 seconds into round one, declaring your winner by submission due to armbar, Zach Price. All right, Zach, I'm sneaking up behind you here. Hey, first of all, I want to congratulate you on the victory. Big moment there in the first round. Obviously, we see the results of that, man. Tell us, what was going through your mind right after that slam?
Really, I just decided that I wasn't going to keep distance. But I wanted to be long with him, so I started spinning a little more. Then after he put me on the floor one more time, I said, no, I'm going to take your arm. Yours is mine.
Look, you looked like you were comfortable no matter where it was going to go tonight. What was the game plan coming into this bout?
Kind of stay long, use my distance, use my traditional arts and stuff, and then use my jiu-jitsu as backup, and obviously that came through for me, so that's great.
Well, look, I know you got some celebrating to do, so I want to let you get to that, but before I do, anything you want to add, anyone you want to thank?
I want to thank all the gyms I've been affiliated with Los Primos Boxing Club, Tipping Point Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, Hard Drive, and anywhere else that has ever gotten any rounds with me, rolls, spars. I love you guys. Thank you.
Well, hey, we're definitely looking forward to the next trip here. Until then, ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it one more time for your winner tonight, Zach Price.
That kid's got a future.
Oh,
all right, folks, we're going to have a brief 10-minute intermission. When we come back, we'll have the main portion of tonight's card, including the all-professional portion. That's all coming up right after this 10-minute break.
Hey, everybody, Jason Bermas here for CagedAggression.tv, and we are with the co-main event, Marty Vansel. He'll be fighting Chuck Roebuck in a heavyweight battle. Tell us what's going to happen tomorrow night.
I'm just going to bring the heat and try to get the win.
So what are we looking for here? Are we looking to take him to deep waters? Are you looking to take him down immediately and just ground him out?
Whatever happens, happens. We prepare for both. Quick fight, long fight, whatever draws out.
And obviously you're in a heavyweight. You put on some pounds for this one. How did that feel going in?
Felt good. Did a lot of weight training instead of actually having to cut weight or any of that. So put on some muscle for this one. So
do you think that this is where you're going to stay at, or you think eventually you go back to 205, or is this it?
I'm going to drop down to 205 for sure.
All right. We look forward to seeing you in that cage tomorrow. Anything else you want to tell the fans?
That's it. Thank you much, sir.
Thank you. We are with Chuck Roebuck. He is in the heavyweight co-main event. Tell us what's going to happen tomorrow night.
Well, it's going to be a good fight. Basically, I don't want to be, I'm not one of them cocky guys, but I mean, I look to put on a show my first time here, go main event. So, I mean, got to make it worth my while.
So tell us about the camp. How did it go? It's been a while since you fought. It's tough to find an opponent. How was this camp? What do you expect to do in there?
Well, this camp went a lot easier than my last one, because my last one I was getting ready right after I tore my bicep tendon off my elbow. So the weight cut was real easy this time. Did a lot of grappling, a lot of jiu-jitsu, a taekwondo guy. Kickboxing's usually my deal, so, I mean, but I'm not a bad wrestler either, so.
So you're fighting Marty Vansel.
Yeah.
What have you seen of him, and what does he bring to the table against you?
He seems like a really nice guy. I've seen him fight a few times. Really excited for the matchup. Looks like a really good wrestler. I don't know if he does a little Muay Thai at his gym, too, but just super excited to meet the guy and then fight the guy. All friends before and friends after.
We like to hear that over at Caged Aggression, but that won't get away in the battle in the cage. So you got anything else for the fans as we wish you luck tomorrow night?
Just expect a good show, heavyweight showdown. So.
All right, my friend, good luck.
Thank you.
I'm with Sinjin Ruby. He's facing Dominic Martin in the main event, 145, Caged Aggression. Tell us how it's going to go down.
You know, I'm going to go out there, do my thing. He's going to do his thing. Only one man can come out on top. You know how that goes.
I do. Tell me about the camp. How was it?
Bro, the camp went easy, really. I mean, it's just been a lot of hard work, dedication, you know. Summit, you know, my home place, Grace Place, Tiger's Den. You know, I've just been doing my thing, doing whatever it takes to get ready.
So 145 is your home. Obviously, saying doing whatever it takes. Are we taking him to deep waters? Or are we trying to get him out of there early?
Honestly, it don't matter where it goes, honestly. I mean, I'm ready for any aspect of the game. That's the biggest thing, right? You got to be ready for anything, so that's where I'm at.
All right, Sinjin, we wish you the best. Is there anything else you want to tell the fans out there?
Yeah, I just want to give a shout-out to all you guys. Without you guys, this isn't possible. Sorry about that. It also isn't possible without our troops, so thank you guys for serving. Shout-out to my sponsors. You know, they're a big part of it. Southern Iowa Heating and Cooling. And then I got smoking hot. I just appreciate you guys for giving me the opportunity as well. It's going to be great working with you guys. Thank you.
Absolutely. We'll see you tomorrow night. I am with Dominic Martin. He'll be in the main event against Sinjin Ruby in a 145 battle. Tell us how it's going to go tomorrow night.
Fast finishes, the only way I know how. The heat, Dominic Martin. You know I bring it.
So you're looking to get in there, first round finish. Are we looking for a sub, a KO? How are we doing it?
I know my opponent's probably going to see this, so just make sure you keep your hands up, your chin down, because it's going down.
So how was the weight cut? How was the camp? You're down to 145. You're looking good. How'd everything go?
After breaking my back and being out for 2 years, I had the easiest weight cut of my life. This was the most official camp I ever put together and the best shape I'm ever going to put in into this cage.
Well, we wish you the best tomorrow night. Is there anything else you want to tell the fans?
I want to say thank you to my girlfriend who's sitting at home taking care of our dogs. She did a lot for me, a lot more than most people. And then also my dad who's sitting over here. All the people that really come together to put together a camp for somebody, that's really what makes a difference. So win, lose, or die, I know you guys are on my team.
Excellent, Dominic. We're looking forward to it.
All right, folks, welcome back to the main portion of tonight's card. Couple reminders. Don't forget, as soon as the lights go down here at the River Center, join us for the official Caged Aggression 33 after party and awards presentation. That's following tonight's show at the Dam View Inn. And don't forget, we're back here again tomorrow night. And for everyone planning on joining tomorrow night's show, hold on to that ticket stub from tonight. Show them your ticket at the door tomorrow night. Get $5 off the ticket for tomorrow night. That's save tonight's stub. Show them at the door. You get $5 off for tomorrow night. And last reminder, don't forget to head on over to our friends at the Sneaker Vault. Grab your very own commemorative event souvenir t-shirt. And there's no better way to show support for your fighter than getting the special event t-shirt, courtesy of our friends over there at the Sneaker Vault and Old Town Heating and Air. Best way to show support for your fighter, and of course, proceeds from the shirt go to help support that particular fighter. If you're ready for the action, we're gonna get into the main card right now.
Yes, we are back. Jake Whitman getting ready to face up against Bryce Everson as Jake Whitman makes his way into the cage. Aggression Cage, fighting out of Summit MMAG Dell's gym out of LeClaire, wrestled most of his life and wanted to continue competing. Thinks it's a good matchup, thinks both of them are wrestlers, but he thinks he has the advantage everywhere and feels that his mentality will be the difference maker. Looks up to somebody I look up to, one of my favorite fighters, Robbie Ruthless, Robbie Lawler, and Frankie Edgar. Can't go wrong looking up to Ruthless. You know him, don't you, Jen?
I just say, I have an idea who he is.
You might have met him once
Heck
or twice.
Heck of a video game player.
Is he?
Oh, he was a gamer, yeah, back in the day.
Lawler just turned 40 years old this week.
Wow.
Still at the top level of his game in MMA.
One of the most exciting fighters of all time to watch.
Without a doubt. There's your boy. I mean, Trowers gets the crowd going. He gets the crowd going.
That brother needs to be on a stamp.
Jordan Trowers is the man, and we will have the privilege of calling his strap tomorrow night. And our man Jay, who's entering the cage right now, he's the underdog, according to the polls, not quite hitting 40%. So if you think he's taking this one against Bryce Everson, make sure to go over to cageaggression.tv and take part in those polls.
The polls are fun to watch, man, because sometimes those bad boys change within moments.
Are back from intermission as we move into the second half of night number one, Caged Aggression 33. The trifecta has only just begun. Referee Bruce Allen stepping into the cage, getting ready to do his jab. Jake Whitman, final instructions from his coaches and teammates.
I like the roll stomp. Nice way to enter the cage right there.
Don't blow your knee out doing
this. That's all I'm thinking. Just careful on that hop. Don't pop that knee off. You don't do that.
You know, it wasn't the one-handed handstand. Some of these guys now like to do the front flip. That's a little much.
I'm with it.
You know, the wrestling roll into a little bit of jump stomp.
I get it.
Bryce Everson getting ready to step into the cage, fighting out of Marty's MMA out of Comanche, Iowa. Started as a wrestling coach at Iowa Top Team and
Clinton, Iowa, then decided to try out MMA as a competitor. Feels he is a superior wrestler and a lot stronger. Feels his striking in jiu-jitsu will also be a difference maker, and he's eager to display that. A lot of his strength in wrestling, work ethic, toughness, coachability. Kamaru Usman is one of his heroes, as well as Justin Gaethje. This is his second fight, and he feels he's excited to show his improvement from his first fight, October of 2021. Champ, let me ask you something about coachability. How important is that component?
Oh, I mean, it's two ways. Very important when, like, you don't have to chase them down. They're always in the gym. They're always wanting to learn. But where it really comes into play is the ability to listen during the fight, to slow it down so that you can hear what they're saying, allowing those sets of eyes to be able to see things from on the other side that you're not going to see.
Yes.
That's those two different styles, right? But the coachability, that they show up every day, they do everything they're supposed to do. I love that aspect, right? But the coachability inside that cage, that's a whole other level.
That's got to be, I mean, supremely important. When your adrenaline's going, you're in that fight or flight mode, ready to take care of business. Like you said, you got to be able to listen and see things, or allow your coaches to see things you're not seeing and listen to what they're seeing that you might not be.
Well, and I always used Matt Hughes back in the day. He would go grab his opponent, run him back over to the corner, set him down, you know what I mean? And with Miletich, I was always circle out and drive my opponent back, but we all had that, can you hear me? You have to touch your ear and make sure that, get that adrenaline out of the way, get that tunnel vision out of the way, get into the fight, get into the moment so you can hear everything. That's huge.
Yeah, I can only imagine how big that is. As we are getting ready to kick it off, once again, Bryce Everson, Jay Huettman. Man, those first rounds, man, or those first rounds of fights we saw, absolutely amazing. Zach Bryce at the end of there, that last before the intermission, incredible first round knockout over a very game, Nick Woodford. But, I mean, we got to go back to that Marshall Kremenak and Zach Pridemore fight. That was just impressive. Oh. Kremenak, even though he picked up the L, he won in a lot of people's eyes.
He won me over. His toughness. And that, one thing I was going to ask was there a size? Because I noticed he came on last minute. There had to be a size difference. Like, maybe he was the smaller fighter.
He definitely
going into
was.
Him, but you could just see it in there. You know, so, again, it's just, I'm just so impressed. I think we have an equipment malfunction.
Is that what's going on?
I don't know. He's been sitting there staring at the front of himself for quite some time. I'm not 100%. Backup shorts, maybe. Backup socks. They don't like the way, I think, the tape on the ankle.
Yeah, I'm seeing some tape going on there.
I think they're cutting.
Taking it off. Is that legal?
I think they may have to take it off. Like, maybe shouldn't have had it on there. Not 100% sure. I was like, you know, we don't like long toenails, but I think they're trying to take it all off.
Yeah, cutting the tape off of his ankle, referee saying it, LT Gray Josh Neal just gave me the heads up on that as well.
So there is, you cannot tape them, or do you have to check beforehand, or did they have to be cleared?
I would have checked before that.
I don't believe that you're allowed to tape the ankles. I think that they allow the braces that are cloth.
Okay.
Right? But I'm not 100%. You know, it's been a long time since I've seen anybody with those ankle braces, but I'm pretty sure that you cannot wrap them, and that is the issue right now.
Okay.
So they are taking those off all the way.
I mean, I can only imagine that's got to be a difference maker if you connect with a nice head kick or something with your legs all taped up. That adds a little stank to the
back. There's a reason why we did tape them up, to protect them, give them stability on the ankles, huh? You know what I mean? It's a little harder to go after those heel hooks, you know what I mean, those ankle locks and stuff. You just had to tape them up.
Almost like the old school days when you could stand in there with some Dan Severn wrestling shoes.
Oh, you could put a wrestling shoe right across and try to put laces across the legs.
Get that ASIC Tiger tattoo on your face. Yeah, I would think this is something his coach in this corner would have known that you couldn't do, but...
Yeah, that is the... I feel for the opponent that's been sitting in the cage waiting.
Yeah. Well, I mean, let's look at this right now. We can't quite see what's going on.
We got to stop this. This got to be a DQ at some point. What are they doing?
I'm
just saying, like, when do you get a 15, you know what I mean? Well, wait for 15 minutes.
The length of time is letting you know that it wasn't just a small little wrap. It took a little while to get those things in.
Yeah.
And like you said, the thicker that is, not only is that going to tighten you up, but may include a little heavier shot to the noggin region of the head. Here we go.
That'd be a training injury he was trying to take care of?
That's, again, another thing. Is it a comfort
thing? Ladies and gentlemen, our next fight of the evening is scheduled for three-minute rounds in the Cage Aggression Amateur Lightweight Division, powered by McCarl Family Racing. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 5 feet 10 inches tall and weighed in at 155 pounds. He trains at Summit Training Center and is sponsored by LeClaire Auto Service, Riverview Roadhouse, Nicole's Creations, and Raw Personal Training. Joining us from LeClaire, Iowa, Jay Hudeman. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5 feet 10 inches tall and weighed in at 158 pounds. He trains at Marty's Martial Arts and is sponsored by Pinnacle Supplementation, Weber's Gym, and Everson Construction. Joining us from Comanche, Iowa, Bryce Everson.
Bryce Everson and Jay Hans Whitman, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, about ready to get it on.
And you know, you were mentioning in the very beginning before we knew there was something going on with the ankles, maybe something with the cup. I've seen him messing with that cup. It looks maybe like it's in a bad place. Maybe it's going to be uncomfortable. Let's see where this goes.
Very pronounced.
Yes, it is a pronounced cup. I wonder if it's a steel cup. What are your feelings on that, Jens?
I have a steel cup. I had one always. Tied it down. Loved it. And I still almost lost the nugget from a shot.
Is that because one of the boys got in between that
That's
steel cup?
That's because he kicked it the first time and the cup got moved and the boy was off to the side.
Ooh, good run
then
right
he just
there.
Threw a straight leg up the middle. It's gone actually pretty viral here recently. Nice shot, though. GG coming in. Everson trying to lock up that body because of the punches by Jay.
Whitman opening up with some shots here. Everson with Whitman back up against the cage there for a takedown.
Everson trying to get that trip in, position his leg in the correct way. Goes for the
nice
shot.
Nice
there
ball. Nice ball. Ball. Looking to try to create some space. Pummel get those hands inside. There you go. Get that over-under position. Start from there. Throw some knees.
Good body shots by Jay right there to try to get loose.
There you go. Try to spin it off. Nice job. See what we can do from here.
Good knee on the inside.
Very nice knee. Both these guys exchanging knees here. Whitman looking to have the strength advantage here, but Everson fighting back.
No, he's doing a good job. Goes down on his low single.
Everson taking some big shots while trying to take that ankle. Good balance right there by Jay Whitman.
What a scramble by Jay. And able to throw some punches and do some damage.
Oh.
You can tell with Bryce, I don't know what he wants to do stand-up-wise. But he's looking, he wants to get this into his safety zone or his comfort zone as fast as possible. And he's willing to take about 15, 16, 17 shots in the process to do it. If you notice, he's still not throwing any kind of shots. He's not improving.
Jay's got to watch those hands in the cage. He's already been reprimanded by the referee once.
Yeah, there he goes.
There he goes again. Bruce doing a great job of getting in there and saying, hey, get those fingers out of the cage.
Bruce Allen is supremely
I like how he got the leg free all together. Now he's able to get the leg back.
Back to their feet.
Ooh, right left.
Whitman firing away.
Another good left that gets right through.
Everson in a serious
nice
defensive mode here.
In on the double.
With the shot. Another shot. Good job of defending that and sprawling there is Whitman.
Jay's had great defensive control every time that shot has come. He hasn't gotten too uncomfortable yet. But I'll tell you what, Bryce Everson has not given up on that leg. About 20 seconds to go in the first round, folks.
Everson pretty singularly focused on that leg.
Definitely winning this round and giving him some shots to think about.
Somebody's leaking.
Oh, Everson on the back, steps over.
10 seconds.
Trying to get that neck, not quite. Slips off. And Jay Whitman back with some big hammer fist.
Good first round for both of them.
Big shots, big shots. Looks like they're going to stop it.
Well, that's the end of the round.
End of the first round.
Couple lefts and right got through. Maybe a late shot or two, but it's tough. I didn't hear the bell.
How are we scoring that one, boys?
Yeah.
That's 10-9, Jen.
Oh.
But you know what?
I could have thrown a 10-8er in that bad boy just because I thought that fight was stopped. But see, the biggest issue right now, if I may, is Bryce has got to figure out he has no striking. He has no striking, no real defense of it. You can tell he's a straight wrestler and he's trying to shoot that low single. And the problem is Jay's doing a great job of sprawling and then brawling. He's throwing the shots. He's damaging him all over the place. And that's something Bryce has got to figure out. You got to know, man, if you can't knock that takedown down right off the bat, you got to bail on it because you're just taking repetitive shots, boom, yeah, boom, boom, over and over.
Like I was saying, they seem to be rather singularly focused on that leg of Jay, but Jay seemed to be way more versatile with his offense.
I'll say that Bryce had one small moment of shine about 15 seconds to go when he got that back.
Yep.
Jay Whitman was able to flip him right over and get those strikes in. If he is able to wrestle him down, find that back, and maybe go for the submission, the second round could be a little bit different.
Well, see, the issue, not to cut you off, but that's one thing, is Jay has got the combination. He's an MMA fighter with wrestling.
And he had some great sprawls. The defense was there.
That's what I mean. He's got that sprawling ball going. He's got the hands. He's comfortable throwing hands.
Jay's got some deceptive strength going on for him, too.
Oh,
right,
right
hand. Hand with the right left.
I love how he comes with that big sweeping hook.
Big right
power
to Bryce.
Shot by Bryce.
Ooh, Bryce with a big right hand. It looks like the corner told him, hey, look, you're going to have to stand a little bit if you want to get those shots in.
And I like it because he's just throwing a heavy, heavy shot. Now one of those things is, based on his stance, is this his punching stance or is this his wrestling stance? Meaning that power hand would be in front. Otherwise, he's lost and he's staying in his striking stance.
Ooh, big right there.
Bryce got to get them hands up. Jay's finding a home with them ones and twos.
Jay Whitman came in with a couple of really quick left jabs in the setup. Got that right across. Came in with the combo.
Ooh.
Bryce Everson still looking to clinch.
Jay's piecing
another
him up.
Left.
Jay is piecing
another
him up
left.
Shot.
Oh, right, left, right. Right comes across.
Nice inside trip.
Takedown.
And here it is.
You
Here's
can tell
Bryce's
Bryce is
moment.
A wrestler. He's 100% wrestler.
Yeah, totally.
And he's in there the way inside trip. Nice job. Now he's got to figure out what are you going to do from here. You've got a lot of score. You've got a lot of points you got to make up right now.
Whitman does a good job of kicking out. Had that butterfly early.
Bryce kind of let him back to his feet there.
Bryce looks a little winded.
He definitely does.
And he's stepping back after that 1-2.
I think above everything else, he's just looking overwhelmed. Jay is walking down, throwing the shots. Bryce is just looking lost. There it is. He has a hammer for a right hand. If he could somehow find his way, get comfortable. That lead hook lets you step in and then fire that right hand. It's there. You've got the wrestling prowess. You can see it, but Jay has got the confidence.
Ooh. Big welt on the left leg of Bryce Everson there.
Yep,
and the lower leg shot from Jay. Jay needs to go back to piecing them up with them ones and twos. They may not be doing a hell of a lot of damage, but it's...
Ooh, another good left, man. That straight left is finding a home almost every time, and he's wearing it on his right eye.
Oh, without a doubt.
Big shots, nice
shot. I can see it happening. Trip.
He's doing a good job of staying nice and heavy, even though he's got that over-under. If he's looking for that, he's looking for that salty, looking for the throw, got him in trouble.
About 30 seconds left in the second round.
Jay definitely capitalizing on Bryce not setting up that attempted toss there.
And in a decent position right here.
Off to the side.
Side mount, yep.
Looks like he's going to try to step over a crucifix. Oh, kind of gets it
go.
Right there.
He
a half a crucifix.
Yeah.
Up, stepped out of it. I would have loved to be able to see him way down on that and then rain down some elbows. You see him kind of lazy hammer fist right now in kind of a fight for control.
He's scoring, though.
Oh, it's another Jay Whitman round.
Without a doubt.
And this is it. You know, Bryce Everson has to find out whether he's going to be able to land one of those big shots. It doesn't look like the wrestling is going to be there for him. Even when he drags him to the ground, Jay Whitman is finding a way to get to an offensive position.
Well, and that's it. There's no point to the ground once he gets him there. He hasn't been able to do anything there. He hasn't been able to hold him down. Unfortunately, as tough as this kid is, he's just very one-dimensional at this moment.
Yeah.
And so he's got to figure out, if he can just got to figure out how to step in and throw a big right hand, land the bomb. If you can tell, he's got the grit. He's ready. He's fired up.
Bryce is having some issue over here in the corner.
I can't tell if he's angry. He's looking like he wants to throw down and do something. The kid is just so tough. I mean, he's just tough if he just had the skills to go with it. But Jay, again, look at the way he's coached. Look at the way he's learning the feints, walking in with his hands, doing a really good job, just breaking it down, throwing the combinations, landing the shots. Just the all-around MMA fighter right now. What can Price do? Get mad like he looks like he's doing. Land something heavy. That's all you've got. But you got to aim it. Your eyes have to be open. You've got to set it up a little bit.
And you know, my suggestion to him is keep an eye on that big left straight, try to get a dodge and get that overhand right while that's coming in, the counter shot.
Here we go, third and final round, touching up the center of the cage, Bryce Everson, Jay Hans Wettman. Jay, just keep doing what he's been doing.
He's been very good with his hands, supporting all the offense. They're high, he's relaxed in there. You know, I like Bryce trying to mix it up right there with these body kicks.
Like he said, Jens was saying, you know, the wrestling's not working. He's got to fix something for this third and final round.
Well, I'll tell you what, that left did not hit him as hard. He grazed him, but he didn't fall with the right. Here's the shot again, but that sprawl every time. Great. Look at that.
He's shooting from a distance, and again, big-time wrestling, right? We like to use our hands. He's still going to come after it with that second shot, drive in. But again, the setups are those hands.
Ridiculous flexibility from Whitman.
Unbelievable. Right? My man hits the splits and starts going left to the face.
I mean, because he's trying to get the takedown. Bryce had a great, I mean, he still does. He has his ankle pulled all the way back behind his bottom, and he was still pulling that sprawl. Got to the cage, and you know, you look at Jay right now, he's cage walking right now. He's getting, he's on a knee. Ooh, he's taking
there
some shots.
Big right hands.
Bryce landed a couple big shots.
This is where he needs to be. Be the wrestler. Get your legs
on
in.
Back,
watch your hips.
Neck.
Watch
got
your hips.
He's
got
her. He's
got
her tight. It's going to be a huge upset. It's underneath. Can he finish?
Jay's trying to figure it out. Trying to fight the hand.
Jay's
going to go out. He's trying to get it. It's in tight. He's got to let it. He's peeling the hands. Is Bryce going to be able to short choke it? Is he going to be able to get with the short choke? It's in tight.
He got it loose.
I can't believe he's holding it off and still fighting. You have got to be kidding me right now.
He's right in front of El Tigre, Josh Neal. Josh is shouting instructions to him to 2-on-1, which is exactly what he did.
And right now, we still got 1:10. This is not a great position for Jay Whitman.
He got it back in. It's nice and tight. It's in tight. He can't fight the hands. Trying to short choke it. Is he going to be able to get this? Can he hold on?
Man, it's underneath, too. I am shocked he is not tapped. He is fighting those hands successfully, though.
Wow.
I can't believe he's finding the space to breathe.
Yeah,
I can't believe this hasn't just
he's
put him all the way under.
Right now. He's rolled out. He's got hand control, which is nice. You know, this is a big round for Bryce Everson, but unfortunately, he's going to need the finish in the next 35 seconds if he wants this scrap.
I can't believe he's in there digging again. I can't even begin to tell Jay, the toughness of Jay right now to survive through this. This is absolute insanity.
He had that bad boy sent in there tight.
Oh, he did a good job. He's still going to work his way around and finish up on top.
Oh! Jay Whitman in the guard. Bryce Everson escaping.
I can't believe that he just made it through that. I can't believe how tight that was. I can't believe Jay made it through there.
He threw a hammer fist in the final seconds. What a
Jay
fight.
Hans Whitman bringing the A-game tonight.
What? Great fight. The type of fights that get the crowd going here at Caged Aggression.
Absolutely. This is what we've come to know and love about Caged Aggression MMA. These boys are tough, man.
Yes, they are.
You step into the Caged Aggression cage, you better pack a lunch.
Well, I'll tell you what. Bryce didn't come out in that third round to lose. He had the eye of the tiger. He went in there. He didn't quite get the shot that he wanted. Jay had done some great work. He was actually on the way up for that wall walk. Made one mistake. Bryce all over his back. All over his back. Got that arm under the neck. Locked it in. And Jay Whitman said, not today. Not today.
Not
unbelievable.
Today.
I cannot believe that he didn't pass out. Obviously, he wasn't going to tap, but, you know what I mean? That's the thing. Bryce. The power of this kid. We got, if we could get you figured out on the striking. Come on, I can't believe both of you. Wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah, tough kid, Bryce. Like both you said, add some more offense to his arsenal.
Impressive.
tough, gritty performance by both fighters, man. Hey, Whitman, what a tough kid that is, man. Oh. You're seeing the replay here. He had that rear naked, well, we're seeing towards the end of it, but yeah, how his face was turning purple, I'm surprised.
Oh, it was in as tight as I've ever seen when I say it like that. I couldn't believe how tight that was in there. And his short choke that was able to put him out. I don't know how he fought out. I can't believe he fought out of it. That was crazy. And that was the thing for Bryce Everson. He just wanted that one opportunity. That one opportunity. Boy, he capitalized. He damn near 10-8'd it. And that's the thing is, like, how close is that to a 10-8? When, I mean, even if Jay wouldn't have reversed at the end.
We go to the judges' scorecard for our decision. Our judges scored this contest 30, 27, 29, 28, and 29, 28. Declaring your winner by unanimous decision, Jay Huteman. Congratulations on the win. It sounds like there might be a few people over here that are okay with that win. Tell us how you're feeling now.
I feel great, man. It's a lot of work, and I just want to thank everybody for coming out and supporting me. It means more than anything you guys could ever imagine. I love you all.
I see you holding your arm there. Did something happen during the fight, or?
I just like telling you nice. I don't know what to do with my hands.
I have a hard time, too. Well, look, I did notice there was a spot there in the last round. Looked like he had a choke in pretty deep. Did you ever feel like you were in any kind of trouble at that point?
Oh, yeah, shit, that was tight. But, you know, I don't quit. I don't quit nothing. And he wasn't going to get me.
Well, look, it was definitely a very entertaining bout tonight. We're looking forward to seeing more of you in action. But until then, anything you want to add or anyone you want to thank before I let you get to the celebration, Jay?
Yeah, I want to thank Bryce for coming out and helping me put on a show. He's a great dude. We can get a beer after this or whatever. I want to thank all my sponsors, Clear Auto, Riverview Roadhouse, Nicole's Creations, Raw Personal Training, any others I forgot. I want to thank Eldred Nunn, Sean West, Tim Hernandez, Junior Hernandez, and Delph's Pro Center also. For all the help and all the wisdom that you've given to me.
Well, we're definitely looking forward to seeing what's next. But until then, ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it one more time for your winner, Jay Huteman.
Great scrap. Before we get to the next one, Jens, I think you were trying to make the point that had Bryce Everson got that 10-8 round, that could have been a draw of the fight.
Yes, and then I started hearing all the scorecards after, like, they're not giving 10-8s to anybody. I can't believe
hard to come by around here.
They are very, very hard to come by. But that was the thing, is at the end of that, especially had he not the last 15 seconds turned that over and ended up on top, how could that not be a 10-8? He was surviving.
I was shocked at the 30-27, but hey, you know how it goes in MMA, judging.
100%.
Don't leave it up to the judges.
Never.
As we move on to our next bout, James Martin about ready to take on Brock Swinburne as James Martin makes his way into the cage, the aggression cage. The White Wolf is fighting tonight. He started training karate when he was 4 years old. Started BJJ when he was 18. Started MMA at 22. Just excited to get back into the cage. Feels like he's becoming very well-rounded. However, he's got to stay on his jiu-jitsu, and he feels that's his best weapon. He loves the mindset of Wonder Boy. Once again, a little shout out to Stephen Wonder Boy Thompson. He's got to give a shout out to the guys at Peoria Athletic Club and Battle Horse MMA. He had his face broken in his last fight.
That's always fun.
Yeah.
That's what I look forward to.
Clearly
I
always want
like a bone broken in my face, something disfigured.
I'm good.
Maybe something takes my nose to the other side.
You know, we've seen that happen in the Cage Aggression Cage without a shadow of a doubt.
And James Martin coming in at the polls as the favorite, a little over 58%. You think it's Brock Swinburne? Get over to cageaggression.tv and take part in those polls.
Without a doubt. We love the fan interaction. Guys, to be part of the program, we want to hear what you think about some of these scraps. As we keep this train moving, James Martin, Brock Swinburne coming up next.
A little zen moment before entering the cage right here, and here we go.
It is on and popping, and James awaits his opponent, Brock Swinburne, fighting at a Genesis fight in Castle Rock, Colorado. Started in jiu-jitsu and did several tournaments, then wanted something more intense. You don't get more intense than this song. This is my jam from Blast the Mohican soundtrack. Thoughts on the matchup? His opponent is very talented and dangerous, so he needs to be on point. Should be a great fight. Grappling and his teammates are the people that help push him and his strengths. They push him to be better every day. Two of his main training partners, old and new, Frank Young and Art, I can't quite see the name in the lights, but a couple of his training partners are the people that he looks up to. As we are about ready to get down, ladies and gentlemen.
The crew is coming down the cage. It's so great to see all these fighters and gyms supporting their guys, not just in the stands, but in that walkout. I mean, it really shows almost the family-esque nature of these gyms, gents, and you're really a part of one of those pioneering family championship gyms that took the MMA world by storm and really usurped the Gracies as the standard in MMA and brought a whole new era of ground and pound, wrestling, striking, all together.
Conditioning, ridiculous conditioning.
Heritage MMA, man.
I always say you guys are the New York Yankees
and
of
that's
mixed martial
it,
arts,
but,
I mean,
but it is, see, and there's every one of them. That's the thing is, it's your turn, but everybody, they know their turn. You know, it's like the easiest spot is in the cage, ironically.
Yeah.
But most people are like, no way, but that's everybody like, let me get in that cage. We don't want to be on this side watching our brother or our sister get beat up, our coach, you know what I mean? We're like, let us do that and we'll do the cheering. Like, you feel almost helpless and it's maddening. It drives you nuts because you love that much, and you're all that much dedicated to each other. That it's ironic when you say that, but there's no way to tell you. The easiest place is in the cage. You know what I'm saying? And that's and it's funny, but that's it. Because out here, there's nothing we can do, and it drives us mad.
Yeah. Well, the military fighting system, man, was we're iron really sharpened iron, man. Here between you, Tim Sylvia, all you guys, man.
We had that belief in military as he's sitting over there. I'm going to experience that deep thigh kick in practice so I don't get the shock. right? I'm going to experience what it feels like to get hit in the body in practice so I don't get shocked when it happens in a fight. And that's kind of how we believed back then. Because, like, we're going to experience this stuff in here because we're all that mean.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Amateur Super Lightweight Division, powered by the Damn View Inn. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands at even 6 feet tall and weighed in at 166 pounds. He trains with CU MMA and Fitness and is sponsored by Veteran K9, Butter Babes, Barak Boxing, and Vision Fitness. Joining us from Tolono, Illinois, James Martin! And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5 feet 10 inches tall and weighed in at 163 pounds. He trains at Genesis Training Academy and Nyquist Roundhouse Martial Arts and is sponsored by Extreme Painting Plus, Tombstone Diesel, and Fight to Live. Joining us from Denver, Colorado, Brock Swinburne!
James the White Wolf Martin and Brock Swinburne about ready to do it.
About ready to do the dance.
Round one blue, you ready?
It's like that American flag, that wave American flag over there. Good one.
Oh, and Brock's leg, Brock's, yeah.
Lead Brock's leg right off the bat, bouncing that front leg, letting him know that he can strike with it.
Oh, big head kick gets through.
Swinburne shook that one off.
Good leg quick.
Nice little leg kick. Brock's on that quadzilla too, so I know those can't feel good.
Oh, that right hand just goes by.
Swinburne got
power.
Cage got him down. Big scoop. A lot of power there, without a doubt.
James Martin trying to do a little crawling right there.
Walk up the cage.
Got one leg underneath that knee.
Brock making it hard. Oh, back to his feet.
Very, very well done.
Reverse position there.
Nice job getting that underhook right there on the, you know, back against the fence. Nice job by James. And now looking to get the second one, try to break and get him to stand him up.
Swinburne doing a good job positioning that right leg in front of his. Ooh, nice good knee.
I mean, it's definitely that Brock is definitely, he doesn't want to let go of this. He's got to cover up to him back.
Gives that right off. Under the neck a little bit. He's got to watch that hand sneaking under even a little bit more. Takes it out.
I like that Martin just did a good job. Get off the head. Sit back. Get those hips back so you don't get bucked off.
Not too high.
Make sure you focus on those first. Get it flattened out. GG.
Coaches are telling James is a bit too high. He's got to watch the back of the head shots right there. Got the body triangle in. I like that. I like that a lot. A minute to go. Talk about that body triangle and how it can really, really compress the opponent's ability to breathe and move.
Yeah, that's it. Well, if you get him flattened out, which is what I like to hear, then you really take it away like a boa constrictor. It just gets tighter and tighter. And every time you let the air out, you're not being able to get it back. Yeah, yep. It just tight takes that space.
Good elbows and shots, too, on top.
The composure of James right now, Mark, just to sit there and break him down and land these shots. He's doing the right thing. Every little bit of opening, he's capitalizing. Every little thing, he's not overdoing it, but he's just capitalizing, punishing, doing a good job with that wrist control. He's got that, you know, the Dagestani handcuff-ish, but inside wrist control, controlling the other wrist, landing shots, point, the scoring the points, but not doing anything overzealous, so he'll get bucked off his position.
And he's mixing them up. It's not just shots to the side of the head like we're seeing now. Every once in a while, he's sneaking them up in the arm as well.
Well, the ref needs to understand whether or not it's hurting him. It's called intelligence defense, and you just need to let him. Like he just pounded him ridiculously, but more power to him.
Well, that's a true component. I mean, that's a very good point, champ. You know, being able to intelligently defend yourself, even though you're not getting flush shots.
It's not about being unconscious. It's not about being bled. It's about, look, intelligently, you're stuck. And he was in a bad spot. The body was figured forward. He had wrist control, and James did a phenomenal job. Yes, they weren't the hardest shots, but we got to go with intelligent defense at some point.
Yeah. Those add up. Those shots add up.
Swinburne had, you know, most of his success in the beginning of the round, and Martin took it over, I'd say, a little bit before midway, especially when it went to the ground. If you're Swinburne's corner, what are you telling him to do? Are you telling him to create distance, or are we going the route of Couture and putting him up against the cage and looking for a little bit of dirty boxing? Because obviously once it went to the ground, it went James Martin's way.
But the biggest thing is, if you want to keep this clinch, you're going to have to start throwing. You got to do something. You can't just grab a headlock or a head and arm and hold on to it and allow James to maneuver underneath it, move around, get behind your back. Brock, what are you doing with the head? Are you going to throw something besides just grabbing hold of it?
Seeing some signs of damage on that left leg of James Martin. Brock hits the giblets.
Right to the ball, man.
That'll take the steam out of your kettle.
Well, we'll give James Martin a breather right here. Of course, he has up to 5 minutes. I doubt he'll take all five, but it's not a comfortable spot to get kicked in.
No, it's not.
Again, as a man, I think it's literally gone viral. My shot in one FC. It's like, it's up there. A lot of people witnessed it. And like I said, I almost lost my nugget. But, yeah, it was a tough one. It was, yeah.
That's the last thing that I want to wake up to, swollen black and blue.
Hey, the shot they gave me was just in case it blew up on the flight home, because I wanted to go home. And so they gave me a shot of morphine, and off I went, and they sent me home just in case that thing blew up on the way.
So we're just assuming no briefs, no boxer briefs, maybe free range, I don't know.
There's not much you can wear, you just had to hope. Put on your sweats, and just, put on your sweats, call it a day. Here we go.
Round two. Martin rocks.
Ooh, big head kick by Martin, blocked by Pulver, but still got a little bit through. Maybe the second time.
James Martin does have a few inches on rocks.
You know, I do like how Swinburne is trying to step in every once in a while with the leg kick, even though he hasn't had a ton of success with it. There's another inside leg kick, doesn't really get through. Left right by Martin, into the takedown.
Kind of fell into that now. Yeah. I don't know if, let's see what James is looking for right now. If he's going to come off to the side, if he's going to sit in half guard. Good job of throwing that leg and flapping him out, taking the space away. GG, armbar, he spins all the way around.
Looks like he
might be going for it right now as he steps over.
He's going to go.
He's going for the key lock, it looks like.
Yeah. Very impressive.
Textbook.
Yeah, James Martin with a nice key lock submission there.
Talk about that, because he stepped right over, he got the position, and then he did that big pulling jerk.
And the beautiful thing was exactly the way he was over the head, and he was able to, he isolated that arm. Full body, all muscle on just that arm. The way he was able to sit on the head, cut the body in half, and work on just the arm. But if you notice, what I really liked was the patience. He stayed like, I didn't know if he was gonna jump into a half guard, sit inside, then he transitions all the way around. He didn't go diving after an arm bar. He knew what he was gonna get, then he went up. You know what, I'm gonna sit down on his head. I'm gonna isolate, push the head down. I'm gonna isolate just this arm, and I'm gonna wait for 1 second, find my moment, lift up, crank, and rip. And it was a great job. But to be that selective, that was impressive.
Absolutely. Great win for James Martin. Gets the finish in the second round. Another great fight here at Cage the Dragon.
Without a doubt, in the book. These kids are bringing in their A game tonight, man. Very impressive performances all around. The human highlight reel, Brandon Jenkins joining us around Cage side here.
He's getting in from a late flight over from Nevada. As you know, he's now a UFC fighter, and we've seen
ladies
him at the Apex Center,
your
among other places.
Josh Stewart has called a stop to this contest at 1:09 into round two, declaring your winner by submission due to Kimura, James Martin. Come on over, James. First of all, congratulations on the win. Never a tough victory over Brock Swinburne. Hey, what was the game plan coming into tonight?
That was one of the things that we didn't really have a clear game plan. Ever since my injury in October, it's been mainly just trying to focus to get better every day. Become more of an overall fighter. So I've been constantly working on my striking, my wrestling, on the black belt jiu-jitsu. And our friends in Baishou. Professor, I hope you're looking at watching at home. It was just trying to get overall better.
So taking all that into consideration, how you feel you did tonight?
I felt really good. The what we were trying to do today is just let the striking go. And then if he grabs me, that's my world, so let's play with it,
Well, look. We're definitely seeing where the future takes you as far as your performance goes. But is there anything that you want to add to this before I let you get to the locker room?
No, I just want to thank my coaches, my team at home. Thank you everyone for supporting me at home. I can't wait to see you guys tomorrow. We're going to train. I'm not hurt, so we're training tomorrow. Thank you for all my fans over there, my beautiful wife, Cassie. Wherever you stand up, I can't see you. She's awesome. Vision Fitness, Uncle John at home. Barrett Boxing. This guy makes awesome fucking boxing gloves. If you guys don't know, go get some from him.
All right. Congratulations once more on the victory. Let's hear it one more time for your winner tonight, ladies and gentlemen, James Martin.
Most people say when you grow up, you gotta put away the toys. Here at McKee Automotive, we say this get a whole lot bigger. Whether it's spicing up your daily driver or that full custom build of your dreams, we're here to make it happen. McKee Automotive, pursuing excellence with creative vision.
Once again, here we go. Kirsten Davenport going against Frank Young. Frank Young, no stranger to the militant fighting system and no stranger to the cage, aggression cage. As Kirsten Davenport gets ready to step in there, fighting out of Skunk River Grappling Dojo out of Burlington, Iowa. Got into MMA from Jason Sink and Rashad Brooks talked him into it. Thinks this is a good matchup. A lot of experience, of course, with Frank Young. Plenty of experience. Thinks Kirsten feels that his boxing and his quick hands will make the difference. Looks up to everyone in the game. And he fought Jordan the Henchman Henman 15 years ago. Jordan will be joining us on the ones and twos calling the action tomorrow night for night number two of Cage Aggression 33. But going back to what we just saw, you know, Brandon Jenkins coming through. He's fought in the Cage Aggression cage. Like we talked about, this is a proving ground oftentimes to bigger and bigger levels. Just saw a video with Brandon training with former light heavyweight champion Forrest Griffin doing a little cardio out at the Apex Center. So big things can come from people who put in the work and pick up W's here from Cage Aggression.
Well, the bottom line is if you want to make it to that level, you've got to put the work in here and now. You have to do more than believe. You got to grind.
You got to show and prove, baby.
I mean, that's how we got Jens Pulver here in Iowa. He made that move, and he grinded.
100%.
You don't become
I dropped my two
overnight.
Double bags and said, I'm ready to be world champion. I sat on that train for 2.5 days, showed up in Galesburg, and drove over here and dropped the bag and said, I'm ready to be world champ. And then that's when Pat came and picked me up the next day, and I never left.
That's awesome, man. Called a few of Frank Young's fights. One of the first one I called, he made very, very short work of his opponent and tried to replicate that performance tonight against Kirsten Davenport.
Kirsten walking in there pretty relaxed.
And here is Frank Young fighting out of Nyquist Roundhouse Martial Arts, Rock Island, Illinois. Got into MMA because he can't sing or dance and it beats working every day. Thoughts on this matchup? Fireworks. He feels that his strengths are his experience, as Kirsten was saying. Looks up to Jens Pulver, Pat Militant. As he was once part of the militant fighting system, Frank Young being accompanied to the cage by your boy, Jordan Trowers.
Where's my sweatband? I need to get a sweatband like that, a headband like that. Like, I feel like that's almost kind of half homemade. Probably took that off a Nike shirt. I love everything about it. I mean, how could you not? And the crew is down the ramp.
Rolling deep.
And kind of ironic that Frank Young is fighting here in Davenport, Iowa, against Kirsten Davenport.
Yeah. And he's coming out to the jam, the title track from the movie Bloodsport. Talking about Kumite.
Will there be Van Damage in the cage tonight?
He just said Van Damage. My man. My man.
As we keep this train moving, ladies and gentlemen, again, this is only night number one, so we're just getting this party started.
And Frank Young, he's got the fresh haircut with the red dye and the American garb. You gotta love that.
Rocking the Apollo Creed. I love the Bloodsport music. I haven't heard that in a minute.
It's so 80s.
And it's quite 80s.
I'm in it. Gosh, what?
I thought it was Phil Collins' Land of Confusion for a second. So I heard.
You know, we've seen every reboot in the universe. Where's the Bloodsport reboot?
Yeah, no. Oh,
and
for
you know
sure.
What? You give the lead role to Jean-Claude Van Damme, and you're basically the Irishman with him, Robert De Niro style, and you do a shot-for-shot remake. The movie was that good.
I can't say too much about it, but something is in the works. It's a movie, it's a script called Dust Bowl, set in the 1920s, but it's basically a 1920s version of Bloodsport. That's all I can really say about it right now.
Get out, man.
I swear.
Interesting stuff, and Frank Young entering the cage.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next bout of the evening is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Professional Super Lightweight Division, powered by Ducky's Formal Wear, Galesburg. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 5 feet 11 inches tall and weighed in at 163 pounds. He trains with the Skunk River Grappling Dojo and is sponsored by Nay's Boss Chicks Beauty Salon, Brick House Painting and Design, Grind Time Fightwear, and At Pretty Homes. Joining us from Burlington, Iowa, Kirsten Davenport. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5 feet 8 inches tall and weighed in at 163 pounds. He trains at Nyquist Roundhouse Martial Arts and is sponsored by Victory Lap Auto Restyling, Yabba Dabba's House of Glass, Mixteca's Nation, The Rock in Coal Valley, Kale Heating and Air, Bottoms Up on 7th, Balanced Chiropractic, Dark Side Art Company, and Shoot Your Local Pedophile. Joining us from Rock Island, Illinois, Frank the Enforcer Young!
Frank, I'm sorry, go ahead, buddy.
I'm just going to say Frank Young coming out the slight favorite at the polls at 56%, but just a moment ago, it was split down the middle, 50-50.
Hope you guys got your drinks and you don't need to go to the bathroom, because this one's going to be a banger.
And here we go.
Inside leg kick opening up from Frank Young. Kirsten responds in kind with his own kick.
Frank Young has great fundamentals. I like how he's going to the legs right away.
Balance.
Ooh, big right left right there from Davenport.
Kirsten swinging hammers.
The little front kick there too to keep him at distance. I didn't like those leg kicks too much.
The one thing I noticed that when Frank does, he's doing a good job after he throws the leg kick, keeping his hands up.
Good left lance for Frank.
Swinging for the fences is Frank Young. Nice knee.
The face. Another good inside leg kick.
Great shot there for Kirsten. He's got some length on him, so those kind of shots are good to keep that distance going.
That might be it.
Ooh, big knee!
That knee was legal or not, but he was so stunned, I think that's going to be the end of this thing.
Kirsten Davenport is raining down the ones and twos. Referee Bruce Allen steps in, calling a stop.
That is really stunned him. I don't know that he recovered from that. In fact,
I couldn't tell if it was an eye poke or not.
I don't know that it was. I'm worried that he may have fractured something, yes. It was tough to see. He may have cracked his orbital. As soon as that shot happened, it was almost a delayed reaction, but it caught him on that left eye. It still hurt. He was still playing with it. I want to see that replay. Tough to see from that angle. You know, Frank Young was doing a good job of getting those leg kicks in, trying to keep the distance. Kirsten Davenport got in there after that shot and said no more.
The replay on that one, because I cannot tell if that was a flush shot or an eye poke.
I think it was a straight right. You know, we're watching the finish right here, but we're going to watch hopefully right here what that shot that landed him. And that's after that shot.
Yeah.
And that knee didn't come to the head. He went to the body there. But really, that initial shot that stunned him, it looked like it was a straight right. I didn't see his fingers out. Sometimes that knuckle gets in there.
Once Davenport smelled that, since that blood in the water, he jumped on him.
Oh, he was everywhere.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Bruce Allen, has called a stop to this contest at 1:06 into round one, declaring your winner by TKO, Kirsten Davenport. All right, Kirsten, man, first of all, congratulations on a win. Look, a fist fight with Frank Young, never an easy thing. It's kind of like playing with fire, man. What was the game plan coming into tonight?
Well, the game plan was to just use my range and my distance. And everybody thinks just because I'm 42 years old, I'm slow. And then you get to find out for yourself when you get in here.
Well, we'll see how many people step up to that first. But hey, quick question. I wasn't paying as close attention as I probably should. You caught him with a shot that wobbled him. What was it?
It was actually an anchor punch is what it was. It wasn't an uppercut. It wasn't a hook. It was just right in between. and you never see it coming because I drop it here and I fire it.
Did that catch you by surprise when you wobbled him with it?
When he walked away, yeah, a little bit, because I didn't think I caught him as clean as I did. But you see the result.
Well, look, I know you guys are always grinding over there at the Skunk River Grappling Dojo. Hey, let the fans here at the River Center know what's up next for Kirsten Davenport.
Hey, it's whatever. As long as Mike's willing to put this old man on the card, I'll be here.
Well, is there anything that we might have left out before I let you get to it?
Well, I'd like to thank all of my sponsors, everybody who came out to support all of us. I know it's been a rough time for everybody in the world, so I just appreciate y'all for coming out and supporting everything that we do.
Well, look, Kirsten, we appreciate you, and we always enjoy the show you come here to put on. Congratulations once more on the win. Let's hear it for him, ladies and gentlemen. Kirsten Davenport.
Talk over that. I don't think that they are hyena sport. Chuck Roebuck about ready to score off against Marty Vansell. Chuck Roebuck has already got a fan in me coming to the ring, coming to the cage, to Hulk Hogan's old business. The Hulkster, man. Chuck Roebuck fighting at a great place gym, Ruthless Hostility, Knoxville, Iowa. Got into MMA because a guy at his taekwondo school asked if he wanted to try it out. It's all downhill from there. Thoughts on the matchup? Pretty good matchup. Feels like we match up pretty well. Feel his strength, his all-around ability to be a good wherever the fight ends up.
And let me tell you, I talked to Chuck here in this co-main event. He was incredibly confident coming into this cage. The big boys are about to do it.
Yes.
I can't wait. We're at the co-main of the first night of the trifecta. Oh, baby.
On and popping, as the kids say. Charles Roebuck getting ready to come in there and swing the hammers against a very tough Marty Vansell.
The only way I could be more excited right now is Hulk Hogan himself would have come out of the backstage.
Let me tell you what, brother.
24-inch pythons are out the way.
Yeah.
This guy might not have what looks like 24-inch pythons, but he's looking to bring the pain.
Without a doubt.
Tonight at Case of Rest.
Going up against a very tough Martin Vansell out of Central Illinois Combat and Fury Athletic Club, Metamora, Illinois. Got into MMA from Kenny Robertson. Feels the same as his opponent does. It's going to be a good matchup. Because of his strength and his ability to adapt will be the difference maker. And he's a man of few words. Marty Vansell, a very tough competitor, looking to get back into the win column after picking up a very tough loss against a very tough Alec Lorenz, who he himself picked up an L in one of our last matchups against Darian Abbey. But tonight is the night for him to get back into the win column against Chuck Roebuck.
I'll tell you what, if there was a way to win me over more than I'm a real American, it would be ACDC.
Right?
They did it big. I mean, this has been a big 80s train the last 20 minutes.
Battle off.
Right.
His composure, though, I like it. He's just stellar right now.
He was very calm yesterday. Both of these guys, calm, confident, and big dudes.
Yes. That can swing the hammers.
The composure of the cornermen, I think, are more amped. Over here.
Well, like you said, sitting on the other side of the fence, man. It's like,
yeah,
a fable.
Look how fired up the Roebuck's corner is. They fired up. I mean, they're ready to go. They're fired up.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our co-main event of the evening. Scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Professional Heavyweight Division, powered by La Quinta Inns and Suites. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 6'2" tall and weighed in at 264 pounds. He trains at Grace Place and is sponsored by Precision by Nutrition, Bloodline Athletics, and Dakota Fight Gear. Joining us from Knoxville, Iowa, Chuck Roma! And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 6'1" tall and weighed in at 255 pounds. He trains at the Peoria Athletic Club and the Central Illinois Combat Club and is sponsored by Infinity Studios. Joining us from Washington, Illinois, Marty Vansell!
I would not blink for this one, folks. No. And the polls have it again, almost dead even, with Marty Vansell pulling out a little bit of the edge at 54 and change.
Very evenly matched up, from a physical stature standpoint.
First 30 seconds.
Yeah, it is on.
Vansell starting with a couple kicks. I like that, keeping distance. Good right by Vansell, good uppercut.
Oh,
ooh, another right. Good body shots, good trading body shots,
going
big time.
At it here.
Oh, good right over the top.
Oh, uppercut hook.
Oh, Marty got shot by that one.
Chuck Langer left on that. Yeah. Left hook.
Right. Robot shook
did
with
a great job right there. Oh, he's still hurt. This could be the end of Vansell. It doesn't look like he's going to recover. Chuck Robot now going to town.
He is still hurt.
Marty Vansell has to find a way. Off the ground, he did it. Good job.
Wow.
Stopped himself from a quick loss right there. That one did sting him.
He's got to be careful against that. Both of them big men, but he's got to be careful with Robot. Keep his hands up and get some distance.
Good elbow over the top from the back. And again, ooh, big uppercut from Robot.
That uppercut is a big uppercut right there. Nice.
Head snapper.
Robot looks to be pulling down that head a little bit. And they're calling for the knee to the head from Chuck. Ooh. Good uppercut from Vansell on the inside.
Big knee from Robot. These guys got
it. Oh. Big knee from Vansell. Drop Robot. From the body to the head, it was almost a double knee.
Got him hurt. Now his rolls are reversed.
Oh, he's going to town on that head.
Martin
the
is
shot's
firing
there.
Away.
He's trying to fight back.
Referee's about to stop
back.
It.
He's got to do something. Time to move. He
that's it. That is it. Referee steps in the opening moment of the first round. Grand opening, grand closing. Martin Vansell is back in the W column with an impressive victory over a very tough Charles Roebuck.
And I can't wait to see the replay on that. You know, because he was having a tough time up against that cage. He lands those two knees, and it completely changed the complexion of
absolutely.
That fight.
Absolutely. I mean, like you said in the beginning, don't take a nap, don't go to the bathroom, because these boys were swinging for the fences.
No, it wasn't the time to take a dump. If you did that, I'm sorry for you.
The clinch game was sick, man. The little uppercut, you see someone's head going lifting up. My man was firing over the top. I like how Vance was firing those elbows over the top of the clinch.
And those were nice elbows
in
the clinch.
Yeah, they were sick, man. The uppercut's nice.
You know, in the beginning, when they were both trading body shots, it was almost reminiscent if I was going to see, like, a replay of Don Fry in Pride instead of head into the body.
Oh, you did not just say that. That's exactly what I was going to say. They sat there, grabbed the back of each other's head, and just started punching.
Oh, yeah.
Only
who was
this
that he
time.
Fought? Who was that he fought?
Was it Ishii's no longer with us?
I'm trying
to think.
Yeah,
he really passed away?
Yeah, the guy that Don Fry fought in that's no longer with us, but it's a famous fight.
Yes.
But instead of the head, they were literally just going
holding each other's head. Yeah.
And they just kept going. They literally, the way they did it to each other's body, that was awesome.
It's a good time. Many good times to be had here at Cage Digression. Oh.
Always.
And we still got the main event coming up.
Still got the main. Dominic the Heat Martin, Sinjin Ruby coming up. What an incredible night to kick off the three-night epic. Cage Aggression 33. Here we're checking the replay there. Martin Vansell just raining down the shots there. Hammer fist until referee stepped in and was like, no mas.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Josh Stewart, has called a stop to this contest at 1 minute, 26 seconds into round one, declaring your winner by submission due to strikes, Marty Vansell. All right,
Marty, first of all, man, congratulations on the win. Tell us how you feel. That opened up with a ton of excitement, lots of action, lots of big shots, man. How's it feel walking away with the win?
Oh, it feels great. There was a lot of ring rust, and I just needed to work it out. So,
all right. Well, look, it's no secret. You know, there's times where you give up a lot of size to some of these heavyweights in here. What are the plans moving forward? I know you've talked about 205. I know you've talked about making that your home. Decisive victories like tonight make that a little bit of a tougher decision. Where are we at, bud?
I think I'm still going to drop the 205 and devastate that division. So.
That sounds like a good plan. We're definitely looking forward to seeing what develops there. What did you work on? Anything in particular coming into this fight?
Confidence was really key, and the elbows, I worked those all week, and knees. So.
Well, Marty, I know you got a lot to talk on and a lot to celebrate tonight. Anything you want to mention before I let you get back to it?
I just want to thank my gym and all my training partners. They put in the extra work to get me here, so thank you guys very much, and thank Bob.
Well, we're definitely looking forward to seeing what happens at your new home at 205. Until then, enjoy the victory. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Let's hear it one more time for your winner, ladies and gentlemen, Marty Vansell.
Here it is. The reason for the season for night number one. Sinjin Ruby going up against Dominic the Heat Martin. Sinjin coming out to Darkman X. As he is out of Tiger Dean MMA Summit Grace Ruthless Hostility Centerville, Iowa. Good friend got him into it. I think this is a great matchup for him. Feels like he's very well-rounded. Person he looks up into this is the sport and is his father. Looking forward to this one. I know Dominic Martin has been battling some injuries over the last couple years, so he is back injury-free and stepping back into the cage to do what he does best. Up against Sinjin Ruby.
Ruby was extremely confident when I talked to him yesterday. And he said, look, I train with some of the best people in the world. I can't wait to get in there and do this. And I can't wait for him to get in there and me to watch him do this.
Yes. As this is, ladies and gentlemen, our main event of the evening, which is culminating some amazing fights we have seen thus far. And again, this is only night numero uno. Much more to come tomorrow night and Saturday night. Thank you guys so much. Everybody who's picked this up on pay-per-view, cageaggression.tv. I hope you guys did the full package, did all three. But if you only did it for one night, tonight, I bet you'll be signing up tomorrow because you see what we put down here at Cage Aggression is nothing but solid scraps, solid matchups. The restrictions have been lifted. The packed house.
Thank the good Lord Jesus Christmas. You know, it's about time. But I'll tell you what, Sinjin Ruby is only about 35% on the polls over at cageaggression.tv. So if you think he's the man and he's going to do this, make sure to get over in the polling centers and vote for your guy.
It is about to go down, the main event of the evening right here. Dominic Martin, Sinjin Ruby. Dominic Martin fighting out of Aries MMA, Cleveland, Ohio. Young age, he got in trouble a lot. MMA was the perfect outlet. If I had a dollar for every time I've heard that story. Two skilled fighters looking to prove themselves, and that's what this is, the proving ground of the Cage Aggression MMA cage. Feels his fight IQ, explosiveness, and raw power will be the difference maker. Too many to name, he says, that he looks up to. But his girlfriend is his true hero. Oh, snap. Brownie points.
There it is.
Scored by Dominic Martin.
Very smart when he shows her this fight. He's like, baby, I put it down for you.
Yeah.
I love you so much, baby. Nothing wrong with that, because we got nothing but love for all the Cage Aggression fighters and their families. And honestly, Jens, you know this. A strong family unit, you really need that in some instances
in the
sport of MMA.
You have to have it for yourself. In the cage is one thing, but the months and months and months that you spend together, you have to have it.
Again, this is not it's a solo sport once you step into the cage, but this is a team effort.
Look at how they walk out. It's a solo for about 20 minutes, 15 minutes. But look at that, all the way up until that moment, look at the people that come out with you, the people that are supporting you,
yes,
all the people around the world, you know what I mean, that are watching you and getting behind you. But then you will have to step in for that one moment, and that's what I love about it, is nowhere to run, nowhere to hide.
No.
Nothing says I love you like going out there and taking it or giving a beat, you know?
Take it and give it sometimes. That's it plays out that way.
Put it all back.
Dominic Martin. Moments away from stepping into the cage for this main event of Cage Aggression 33, the Trifecta, night number one.
And Dominic Martin had a game plan. He said he was going in there. He was going to try to get him out of there really, really quick. Extremely confident as well. I probably wouldn't go get the potato chips while this one kicks off either, folks.
Yeah, Sinjin looks like he's ready to go. Dominic's ready to go.
You know, with the heavyweights, it can be one and done quick. These are smaller guys, but we've seen fireworks in this cage, and we've seen comebacks in this cage tonight. We've seen submissions. We've seen KOs. We've seen it all, baby.
And that's what we get, man. Mike Goodwin is so awesome at creating these incredible matchups so we can get those fireworks like we've seen tonight.
I like it. He's feeling it. He's feeling it. They both are.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, fight fans live in attendance at the River Center, and everyone else streaming live on pay-per-view around the world, this is our main event of the evening. Scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds in the Caged Aggression Professional Featherweight Division, powered by 7G Distributing Bud Light. Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner. He stands 5'7" tall and weighed in at 144 pounds. He trains at Summit Training Center and Tiger's Den and Ruthless Hostility. He's sponsored by Smoking Hot Fine Cigars and Vapors, ACDJ, Southern Iowa Heating and Cooling, Plumbing Division, Grind Sports, and Grace Place. Joining us from Cincinnati, Iowa, Sinjin, the Golden Child, Ruby. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner. He stands 5'7" tall and weighed in at 146 pounds. He's sponsored by Yabba Dabba's House of Glass, Squirrel's Tree Care, McCarl Family Racing, and R&R Home Improvement. Joining us from Davenport, Iowa, the Heat, Dominic Martin.
And Dominic Martin looks so much more filled out than he was yesterday when he was cutting that weight. You know, 135, I'd say.
All right, gentlemen, this is the Caged Aggression Professional Featherweight main event. We went over the rules in the back. Do you have any questions, Sinjin? Do you have any questions, Dominic? Touch them up now if you wish.
The Heat ready to bring that heat. Yes.
First 30 seconds. I'm telling you.
Look at Sinjin's got goosebumps.
You can see it. How could you not?
It's on and popping, ladies and gentlemen. Cage Aggression main event.
Keep.
Martin, Sinjin Ruby. Sinjin popping it off with a nice little front kick.
Maybe he's trying to study. I like that idea to feint that hip a little bit.
Oh, Leona Machida.
Dominic with a nice high kick. Oh,
he slipped that. Sinjin is coming for his head there.
Oh, Sinjin Ruby turns it around.
Oh, we got a scrap on the we got wrestling nice on the right hand. Then he's going to kick off the side. GG, take it back.
Back to his feet.
And again. Transition galore right there.
And he's still got that ankle. Cancel Christmas. Dominic Martin making short work for Sinjin Ruby. Opening seconds of round number one.
Picked him up, slammed him down, picked him up, slammed him down, picked him up, slammed him down again. Small man rolls in for a quick for the knee bar, tried to make an adjustment, and then got the inside heel hook.
short but awesome fight. Lots going on right there.
These boys came to scrap, and Dominic picking up a very impressive W, ladies and gentlemen, after being tossed around quite a bit.
Man, I did. Oh, that's heartbreaking. Nice job with the power slam, slam, slam. But just the wherewithal and the composure to roll underneath.
Never quit, never say die here in the Cage Aggression Cage. Even though the outlook looked bleak, Dominic brought that heat. He wasn't ready. He wasn't ready.
One little boo-boo.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Bruce Allen, has called a stop to this contest at 56 seconds into round one, declaring your winner by submission due to heel hook, the Heat, Dominic Martin.
Dominic.
Hey, I got one of these. Let's do it in this, Dominic. Congratulations on the win, buddy. Everyone, if not everyone, should know the story leading up to this, the broken back, the time away. Talk to us how it feels getting the win here tonight, Dom.
Hey, obviously, whenever you come back from something like what I went through, you want to know that you're going to be able to compete. They're going to be able to do what you know you got to do. So I want to take a hard fight. Sinjin had a good game plan. He grabbed me, he locked me up, he slammed me, and my back held up. Hey, I went out there, I still did that shit, you know? So obviously, we ain't got nothing to worry about, baby. We're still rolling.
And hey, I would like to add, it held up three times. Three times. So look, walk us through the finish. Walk us through how you set that up.
So right about the first time he slammed me, I was like, oh shit, that sucked. I definitely should not let that happen again. And then it happened two more times. And I was like, oh man, that really sucked. Even worse the next two times. I should probably do something about this. So that was actually an old Spencer Fisher drill that he used to drill into us. A lot of the time, if somebody got around to your back, you can dive through to the middle, grab a knee bar. He sat back and transferred over to the heel hook, locked it up. And as he sat back, he actually tightened it up on himself. So I wouldn't say lucky, but I got the position. I got what I needed.
It was definitely a beautiful finish. Look, we wish you all the best. Definitely looking forward to seeing what's around the corner for you, Dominic. But is there anything that you want to add to this before we let you get to the celebration, the much-deserved celebration?
Something that, if I'm being quite honest, I've always wanted to do, and I think this might put me in a good opportunity to. If my girlfriend's listening, turn the TV off. But, Mike, if anybody backs out in the next 2 days at 145 or 155, let me know, man, because I'm trying to show out, bro. I'm not coming back for nothing. I'm coming back for everything I said I'm going to fucking get, and I'm here for it.
Well, look, we're definitely looking forward to see what develops on the rest of the weekend and at least in the near future for you, Dominic. Until then, man, soak up this win. You deserve all of it. Let's hear it one more time for your winner, ladies and gentlemen. The Heat, Dominic Martin.